What this is all about today, one day, on what, what they change.
This session of the Joint Committee hearings on the Waco matter is now convened. Good morning this morning. You may have your seats for the witnesses. We have very brief opening statements this morning. We have little time to deal with for them today and really should not because we have some exigency in trying to conclude these matters. This is a very important panel this morning. We started earlier for convenience of our panelists as well as because our schedule today would probably dictate the House will discontinue business somewhere around 3 or 4 o'clock this afternoon. First of all, I would just simply like to open the comments by saying that yesterday was a fruitful day in our discussions of what happened at Waco in regard to the FBI's testimony and the evidence that came in, continuing to give us a stream of what happened in the planning of the use of the CS gas and why that plan was done. We also heard some disturbing concerns that continue to come forth with regard to whether or not the Attorney General in Washington got the kind of information on the negotiations that many of us were hearing, indeed, were going on at the end. No question about the sincerity of our Federal Bureau of Investigation folks negotiating, in my judgment at least, and no question about their earnestness and their belief in what they were doing. But there continues to be some disturbing question as to what degree the information they had and the quality of that information in dealing with the Koresh matter at the very end of all of this was indeed passed on to Washington. We also are left with questions about the gas itself, the insertion plan, and so forth. Today, we're here for the approval part of that, and we want to hear from you for that reason. I do want to comment that part of the testimony yesterday also concerned the situation with respect to the hostage rescue team. We did hear a clarification that that team probably had the ability to stay on the ground in Waco for about 2 more weeks before they would have needed to have been pulled back in order to get retrained and in order to get some time for their proficiency skills to be rebuilt, because they were stretched pretty far. We also heard one comment that I think was of some significance. I do not know what it means overall, but we did hear yesterday that Mr. Jamar had a feeling, that 99% certainty, that the Davidians would fire on the vehicles as they approached to insert the gas. But apparently that feeling was not conveyed to Mr. Potts and perhaps not on up the line. Whether that would have made any difference in the judgment of the Attorney General or others on this matter of use of the gas is not at all clear, but nonetheless that point was made yesterday. Now, I am not going to go further in an opening statement today. Our objective is to be very brief. We want to announce the schedule. We are going to have 2 panels today. The panel that's before us, which is dealing with the question of the approval of the use of the CS gas, that particular plan. Later this afternoon, hopefully early this afternoon, we will have a panel of experts to discuss the fire itself, what caused the fire, which I know has been one of those things debated and discussed and quite controversial. We anticipate that Monday will be a session that will involve presentations of the military's role, to what degree were they involved in support and what activities and advice they gave, as well as a very comprehensive panel on the day of the insertion of the gas itself, that very fateful day where the lives were lost. It is also anticipated now, because of the time that's been consumed in these panels, that it would be unfair to bring the Attorney General up here very late in the day on Monday, and it probably would be very, very late. And so we anticipate having the final concluding session of this hearing set on Tuesday with Attorney General Reno rather than on Monday as previously announced. With that in mind, I would call on Mrs. Thurman for any opening comments she might have.
Mr. Chairman, I have opening remarks, but I realize we have a time problem here with one of our witnesses today, and so therefore I would like just to have unanimous consent to submit mine into the record, because I think it's more important that we hear from these folks.
Without objection. Mr. Zeloff.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Today marks the 8th day of fact-finding hearings on executive branch conduct into the Waco tragedy. Today, as with all other days, questioning will be vigorous. It will be pointed and motivated by our continuing twin aims: discover the truth, and then put things right. I'm convinced, especially after reading my mail this week, and I've read almost all of it, that most Americans recognize the real importance of this constitutional oversight process, They also recognize that it sometimes takes courage to raise very probing and pointed questions. Yesterday, again, a few of my colleagues across the aisle questioned our support of law enforcement. So before turning to the issues we face today, I want to pause and let me be simple and clear. First, because someone asked hard questions about Waco and what happened, there does not mean that they somehow are abandoning our law enforcement. Second, no supporter of law enforcement enjoys scrutinizing the activities of law enforcement community. People at the top and the bottom in law enforcement deserve our respect, and most of them know that they have it. Many have already said that what we are doing by having these hearings is good for America and good for them in the long run. I believe and I'm committed to that process. Constitutional oversight is the bedrock of this nation, and if it falls by the wayside, if it can be run off the road by distractions, then we really have a good deal to worry about, more so than just Waco. Third, it is not just words when people on this side of the aisle say that they know and believe in law enforcement and the men and women who daily put their lives on the line. To the White House, it is damage control, a spin game, a cabinet secretary calling a member and asking him to not ask embarrassing questions, a Justice Department press release explaining away obstruction of justice, an EPA denunciation of a witness who comes to testify before us, a White House spokesman who claims that the Republicans on the panel are against law enforcement. Well, these are all the press stories, but let me tell you, I need only say at once that that is the kind of thing that Americans are sick of, the kind of conduct that disturbs the entire process. Sitting on this side of the aisle today sits more than 100 years of collective law enforcement experience. Mr. Heineman of North Carolina has been in law enforcement for 38 years. He's been a chief of police for 15 years. Mr. Barr of Georgia was a United States attorney for 4 years. Mr. Bryan of Tennessee was a prosecutor for 8 years. Mr. Boyer of Indiana, Mr. Shattuck of Arizona, whose father was a deputy sheriff, Mr. Schiff of New Mexico, all former prosecutors. And the rest, lifetime supporters, all of us, of law enforcement. So we need to stop about the business of being against law enforcement. I think we're all for that, and we're all for making sure that it's totally credible. We're going to do everything we can to see that it stays that way. On the issues, I'll say just this. Our aims are to find the truth one day at a time, to educate ourselves and those who follow these hearings, and to prevent other tragedies by understanding the many flawed decisions that produce this one. We are almost at the end of a set of events that occurred 27 months ago and ended in a deadly blaze. We have all seen it on television. We'll see it again today. Reviewing everything we learned will be impossible, but we've learned an awful lot. A lot of new information. In these final 3 days, I think we'll find out still more information on three untraveled topics. First, how is the CS gas decision, the final go-ahead, really made? Did it develop over weeks, hours, or days? Was it made by the Attorney General Reno alone or not? What was the role of Mr. Hubble, Mr. Foster, or others close to the President and the President himself? Who originated the idea? When and why was an 11th hour offer of surrender, an offer collaborated by the Texas Rangers and also confirmed by Koresh's attorney in detail, rejected? We will then turn to the fire itself and hear from an array of arson investigators. We will hear from the Justice Department on their full theory of how the fire started, and we will objectively try to answer lingering questions. We will also hear from one of the Branch Davidians who escaped, Mr. Olive Doyle, or Mr. Clive Doyle. He will tell us what it was like to survive the fire and what he believes about those who did not. Our day is a full one, but like all of the last 7 days, this one promises to deliver as much light as heat, as much truth as we are willing to ask for, and as much goodness for the country's sake as we can squeeze into 8 or 10 hours. Mr. Chairman, thank you. I look forward to the testimony.
Thank you, Mr. Zeloff. Mr. Schumer?
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, and I'd like to make 3 points this morning. The first is, just as my colleague Bill Zeloff went into a long litany of how the people on the panel are good friends of law enforcement, just as every day, yesterday, just about every member of the other side, before they ask questions, talked about what friends they are of law enforcement, well, I would answer with one line from Shakespeare, "Methinks the lady doth protesteth too much." Next, I would like to talk about the two issues that are really before us today. The first involves what I call real politicization of these hearings. And that is not an effort to find out what went wrong, but somehow an effort to link what happened to the White House. I found it very interesting that my friend Mr. Zeliff mentioned two people in the White House only, Mr. Hubble, who has troubles of his own, and Mr. Foster, who had even greater troubles, as the two people who might be involved. Why didn't he mention all the other people in the White House? Well, we know why. And why is it that there is not a shred of evidence? I read the documents that many on the majority side said they had to have to see if White House was involved. The documents, by their own admission, don't have one scintilla of evidence that the White House influenced this policy. Yes, they were informed, as it would be in a good chain of command, but no influence. But the majority seeks to say over and over again, was the White House involved? That, my friends, is what is ruining these hearings. Not a desire to find the truth and go over the mistakes, but an effort to politicize the hearings and bring in extraneous issues that have nothing, nothing to do with the avowed purpose of these hearings, but by smear, by innuendo, by exaggeration to bring an untruth into credibility. The same problem of moral relativism. So again, just think, why in the opening statement was just Mr. Hubble and Mr. Foster mentioned as in the White House, but none of the other people? I think that shows something. The second question that we have to answer today is, and this is a serious question, this is not like the other one, this is who set the fire that killed 80 people. And again, I would ask my colleagues here to look at the evidence, not at wild theories. Let's remember a few things. Let's remember that the arson team chosen by the Texas Rangers, who both sides of the aisle have praised as a unbiased, capable law enforcement investigators, they conducted an exhaustive investigation and concluded deliberately that the fire was set deliberately by one of the persons in the compound. Let us remember that one of the majority's star witnesses, and one who has made some telling points, points I disagree with, but his points were telling and he was an expert, Dr. Stone, even though he had a lot of criticism as to how this thing came about and what the FBI did, said that the Davidians set the fire in the compound. And finally, proof positive, although I'm sure we'll hear innuendo and doubt from the other side, tapes. Tapes from the compound with quotes on them that are like these. Quote, they got some fuel around in here? Yeah, they even poured it already. Poured it already? Yeah, he got it poured. More quotes. You got to put the fuel in there, too. Got to put the fuel in there. Fuel? Is there a way to spread the fuel in there? There. Quote, so we only light them as soon as they tell me last chance, right? Well, that's the fuel. We should get more hay in here. And finally, after all the fuel was poured, more quotes from these tapes. Tapes that everyone agrees are true, have veracity. What are you going to do? Now we're committed. I want a fire around the back. Keep that fire going. These are tapes from inside the compound. They talk about people spreading fuel. They talk about people lighting fires. This idea that the fire came some other way, this idea that CS gas had anything to do with some kind of explosion unrelated to the fire being set, is wrong. And I would ask my colleagues on the other side of the aisle, this is the most serious charge, even more important than who shot first, to examine in their hearts what the real truth is, to step up to the plate if they really want to give law enforcement an even shot, if not even the benefit of the doubt, and come to the conclusion at the end after they hear the evidence, which I have looked at from top to bottom, that if they believe that the fire was set inside the compound by the Davidians, that they say so. Because the worst part of the conspiracy theory that is running in parts of this country is that the fire was deliberately lit by government agents who wanted to burn these women and children. Every reasonable person in America knows that's not the truth. Everyone who has studied this, objective people, knows that is not the truth. And we will be doing a horrible disservice to the government and the country we all believe in and love if at the end of these hearings, when the evidence, which I believe it will show that is the case, that we still try to say, by innuendo, by implication, that we haven't answered that very serious and very important question, because we know from the evidence, from all objective observers, that the fire was lit by David Koresh.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I now want to introduce our panel of witnesses for today. We will then have you sworn and then begin the questioning. I'm only going to read the introductions, not necessarily in the order in which you're seated. Judge William Sessions is the former director of the Federal Bureau of Investigations. Floyd Clark was deputy director of the FBI. Webster Hubbell was associate attorney general. We have Mark Richard with us. He was deputy assistant attorney general for the criminal division. He had supervisory responsibility for terrorism and violent crime at the time of the Waco happening. Larry Potts, who's with us again today, as well as with us yesterday, was the assistant director for the criminal investigations at the FBI at the time of the Waco involvement. And Dr. Harry Salem, who's also back with us again today, is the chief of Life Sciences Department, Research and Technology Directorate of the U.S. Army Edgewood Research Development Engineering Center for the Department of Defense. He briefed the Attorney General on the CS gas question. If all of you would please stand, I'll swear you in. You raise your right hand. Do you swear or affirm that the testimony you shall give today will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth? Please be seated. Let the record reflect that all of the witnesses answered in the affirmative. We will begin our questioning today with Mr. Bryant. You're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. One disturbing aspect of the fire, as already has been referenced today, that has caused me grave concern over the night was the statements made by the FBI SAC, Mr. Jamar, yesterday concerning the monitoring device, the listening device that had been secretly planted in the Davidian compound, and the fact of the morning of the raid beginning about 6 o'clock when the fire was in, when the gas began to be inserted into the compound, that the live monitoring, the folks who sat there with the earphones on to listen to what was going on in the compound, and they, I assume they had done that for days and days and days before, at this particular crunch time when the chips were on the table, when it had to be determined what was going on inside that compound, when your best intelligence was needed, because Mr. Jamar had said, as I recall his testimony, that if I had known they were spreading gasoline, I would have called off that raid that morning. Yet at that critical time in this entire investigation, or this entire siege, he candidly said yesterday that I don't know why we didn't have that information. Because as the truth has come out in this hearing, what Mr. Schumer read from that tape was just that. They didn't know about it until they listened to the tape afterwards. And at that critical crunch time when they had to have this intelligence as to what was going on inside when the raid was started, they didn't have it. And I hope we get some answers as to why there wasn't somebody there monitoring that at that time, or why they weren't able to hear, which they obviously heard at other times. And that causes me great distress, because had they heard that, according to Mr. Jamar, they would not have continued the insertion of the gas that morning. And I think that's a critical question that the American public need to have the answer to. Mr. Salem, briefly, we talked yesterday, and I think we sort of defined this issue of whether or not to insert CS gas into the compound on a children's level as to whether or not it would kill them. And we've talked about studies, and there's no studies out there as to the effect of killing children or not. And I think we've kind of overlooked that in-between area as to what effect that gas would have on debilitating, disorienting, causing these children to be dysfunctional, again, during this critical time when there was what appeared to them to be a frontal assault on their home, at a critical time when very likely fire could have broken out, which I think the FBI admits that that was a possibility that fire could break out because they were aware of the local fire departments and what their arrival time would be. And I can just imagine, and I hope the agents imagined ahead of time, that if fire did break out and we had inserted this gas and these kids in there had become debilitated and disoriented and certainly panic-stricken,
and they were physically incapable of moving or doing what they typically would do, wouldn't that have some kind of effect on them in terms of disability, disorientation, physical incapacitation in a panic situation?
Is this on?
It's on.
Sir, the effects of the CS is as a sensory irritant. It causes tearing, blinking, and it gives you the feeling of trying to flee from that area. And unless there's an obstruction, most people can get away from that.
We're talking children now, 5, 6, 7 years old. Would it cause them not to be debilitated, disoriented?
According to all of the evidence that is available, there is no difference in the sensitivity for children, adults, or the elderly.
Okay, thank you. Now, let me ask, if I might, a question concerning, and I might ask Judge Sessions or Mr. Hubble, either one could answer this question. Back, I understand Attorney General Reno declined initially to approve this gas plan, and that was on the 16th, which was a Friday. Judge Sessions, I believe you asked for a hearing with Attorney General Reno about this, and I understand she then came to Mr. Hubble's office. I would like to know maybe what went on there, but I also find it somewhat not disturbing, but just a little out of protocol that the Attorney General of the United States would be summoned, if you will, to come to somebody else's office, and I see Mr. Hubble, and maybe that relationship existed, but I didn't know the Attorney General went to other people's office to discuss, because in effect she was both of your bosses, was she not, at that time? Okay, and I just wondered why she was brought down to Mr. Hubble's office, and in essence, what the conversation, what convinced her to begin to consider the CS gas?
Mr. Bryant, the meeting that you're discussing took place at the request of Mr. Hubble, and we came to his office, which is adjoining the Attorney General's office. And after the discussion, he announced to us that she had decided not to. And he said, would you like to appeal? And I said, yes, I would like to talk to the Attorney General. Now, the reasons for that, I'm sure you're aware. I wanted to be sure that there was no political objective at all, because I knew that Mr. Hubble was, of course, connected with the White House. And the only way I could be sure of that was by talking to the Attorney General. And he asked it himself. He said, do you want to appeal? And I said, I'd like to talk to the Attorney General. And she walked across the hall, or down through the conference room, and came directly into his office. I don't think that was an affront to the Attorney General. I think there was a practical way to deal with it. And when she came in, then we began those discussions, which continued, of course, for a good while. But that was the way that it happened, as I recall.
Exactly. My recollection was that we were meeting in my office, which is actually the former Chief of Staff's office, which is just on the other side of where the Attorney General's conference room was. After they said they wanted to talk to the Attorney General, I went down and said, they're in my office, they would like to appeal, and she just said, well, let's go talk to them. And knowing the Attorney General's style, that it was no affront. We didn't summon her to my office, I can assure you that.
Mrs. Thurman, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Dr. Salem, in yesterday's hearing, there was some comment made that you had not published any articles or books on CS gas. Would you like to comment on that? You never got an opportunity to respond to any of the allegations there.
Yes. Thank you. As I mentioned yesterday, I have done original work, research work, and
put the microphone closer to you.
I have done original research and published on respiratory reflexes, respiratory irritants, and I have also, as I mentioned, I'm on the editorial board of inhalation toxicology. I am the chairman of the technical committee for the inhalation specialty section for the Society of Toxicology. So I have a lot of experience in reviewing data and published literature, as well as research reports on various chemicals, both in many fields, in the pharmaceutical field, pesticide field, consumer products, and this type of
Dr. Salem, and going one step further then, did you feel there was any misinformation that was given yesterday that you would like to straighten out for this panel? Would you like to think about it and let me come back to you?
Thank you very much, okay. Yes.
Jim Sessions, yesterday during the testimony, Mr. Potts was asked whether on April 14th letter from Koresh, which had been called a surrender offer, was passed on to you. He stated that he did pass that letter on to you. Mr. Potts was then asked whether he knew if you passed that so-called surrender offer to President Clinton or...
I'm having trouble hearing you, Mrs. Thurman.
I am very sorry.
Thank you.
Well, during testimony yesterday, Mr. Potts was asked whether an April 14th letter from Koresh, which had been called a surrender offer, was passed on to you. He stated that he did pass that letter on to you. Mr. Potts then asked whether he knew if you passed that so-called surrender offer to President Clinton or anyone in the White House. Can you clear up the confusion surrounding this issue and tell this committee, A, whether the April 14th letter was in fact a surrender offer, whether you forwarded the April 14th letter to any linguist or psychologist for analysis, and whether you forwarded the April 14th letter to anyone in the White House?
Ms. Thurman, it may be that Mr. Potts recalls a surrender letter of April the 14th. I do not recall a surrender letter from Mr. Koresh of that date. Did Mr. Potts indicate that he passed it on to Mr. Clark or Mr. Clark to me?
We'll ask Mr. Potts.
Actually, I don't remember saying I passed the letter on to Director Sessions either. If I did, I recall that the information concerning the April 14th manuscript was passed along from Waco to us, to the command center. Not a surrender letter, but an indication that he was going to work on the manuscript now for the Seven Seals. That particular document was provided by our command center in Washington to Dr. Murray Myron, for an analysis. And I think Jeff Jamar testified yesterday as to the results of that were essentially that Dr. Myron said, I don't see anything in this letter that would indicate that he's coming out in the near future. I'm obviously paraphrasing here.
Okay.
That information about the April 14th manuscript was passed along the line. But I don't know whether the letter itself was or not.
Ms. Thurman, that is correct.
Okay.
In terms of some of the contents, apparently, of the manuscript. I was aware that manuscript was there, but I was not aware of what you term an offer of surrender.
Okay. Mr. Clark, it's my understanding that you accompanied Mr. Potts to Waco and met with on-scene Commander Jamar and other members of the crisis management team. Can you tell us about this meeting?
Short answer is a long answer. There had been a series of conversations and with the Department of Justice and inside of the FBI about activities down in Waco. Representatives from the Department of Justice had made a prior trip down to Waco to look into a number of matters, coordination issues, prosecution issues, and they were going to be making a second trip. The FBI was invited to go along and participate in these meetings, and Larry Potts and I accompanied Mark Richard and others from the department down for that meeting. While we were there, we used that opportunity to also meet with our field commanders. We went and looked at all of the facilities, talked with the people that were doing the work in the trenches. We actually got in two vehicles, went to the compound, went to the observation points, developed a personal sense of what the conditions were. It is one thing to sit in a command center or in the environs of Washington, D.C., and see pictures or have things related to you. It's an entirely different thing to be sitting in a facility where people have had to operate for 51 days. You can't begin to imagine the kinds of stress that has to be there for these professional people to endure day in and day out. I think there was some testimony about that these vehicles provided protection for the agents. That protection was very limited. as we pulled up in front of that compound and looked at that facility and peered out that hole of that Bradley vehicle. I've been involved in law enforcement for 30 years, and I've done an awful lot of firearms training and shooting. At a distance of 75 yards with a telescopic rifle, left-handed, with one eye closed, you could put rounds through that opening in that Bradley vehicle. There is no leather upholstery. There is nothing to absorb a round coming into that vehicle. If a round came into that vehicle, it would ricochet around, and everyone in that vehicle would be at jeopardy. Those kinds of dimensions, when you go out to these observation points 300 yards away and you see this building with not only windows and recessed shooting positions, but areas where they had cut additional shooting ports, and you have people looking through telescopic sights for 24 hours a day, 51 days, trying to observe all of the movements, you would occasionally see the glare of sunlight reflecting off the telescope sights of rifles from that building. You begin to understand the threat and the danger to the agents that were there. Those are the kinds of things that we wanted to understand, as well as discuss with those people, not only the SACs who were giving us this information on a daily basis, but the people that were there working, and try to understand what their thinking was. And we came back with a renewed understanding of the issues that were confronting the people. We spent 2 days there, came back and made our report to Mr. Sessions on the 9th.
Chairman just asked me to ask, what was the date of that?
The 7th and 8th of April.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mrs. Thurmond. I would like to make everybody aware of the fact who are up here asking the questions that former Director Sessions has got to leave here about 11 or a little before that this morning. So if you have questions, particularly you've got a burning in your pocket that you want to direct to him, either do it or let us know about it in some way so that we might reorganize the questioning in a fashion that would allow that to occur. Everybody else, I think, can be with us throughout whatever the duration of this panel is. With that in mind, Mr. Shabbat, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Before I yield, I'd just like to respond to the gentleman from New York's comment about the alleged politicization of these hearings. Last week, Treasury Secretary Rubin called a Democrat member of this committee and asked him not to ask any questions that might be embarrassing to the Clinton administration. Now, I think that is truly politicizing these particular hearings and was uncalled for. I would like to, at this time, yield the balance of my time to the gentleman from Tennessee, Mr. Bryant.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Hubbell, let me ask you a question, if I could, regarding some testimony that you have given in May of 1993, which would have been after the standoff and after the fire at Waco. In May of that year, you testified at your Senate confirmation hearing that you had spoken to the President, President Clinton, only about a Supreme Court nominee, and that was in regard to the question about DOJ activities. That ruled out personal contacts with him. But the question, I think, was had you spoken to him about Department of Justice matters, and your testimony at that time was that I had spoken to him only about a Supreme Court nomination. However, an AP story of April 3, 1993 reported you as saying that you gave the President updates on the Waco situation in the early days of the crisis. My question is, based on, I know Senator Bumpers in your confirmation hearing said you were best friends with the President and the First Lady. Based on that relationship, I'm wondering what was the accurate situation in terms of your communication with the President regarding Waco?
With regard to Waco, I did not communicate with the President until after April 19th in any regard. Stuart Gerson was the contact with the White House until Attorney General Reno was confirmed. And then the contact we had with the White House would be through White House counsel, Bernie Nussbaum, Vince Foster, and occasionally Bruce Lindsay.
So in essence, what you're saying is that your testimony before the Senate committee was accurate, but that the AP story, which said that you had provided the President with updates in the early part of the crisis, particularly in the early part of March, that story
and what it alleges in there is inaccurate.
It is inaccurate. Stuart Gerson, I was not even in Washington the weekend that the initial raid occurred. Stuart is the one who talked to the president and continued to do so until Attorney General Reno was confirmed. I do believe that on the Sunday before the 19th, the Attorney General spoke to the president. I know she did because I was in the room. And that was the only contact with the president directly prior to the 19th.
And obviously you had personal contact with the president, I assume, during that period of time due to your relationship, your personal relationship.
That's absolutely correct.
And the issue of Waco did not come up in any of these formats?
It did not.
Conditions. Let me ask another question, if I could, regarding the question that Attorney General Reno asked, I think, a couple of times in terms of the date of the 19th of April as to why now. And again, Director Sessions, Judge Sessions, it's good to see you again. You were the director when I was a U.S. attorney, and many of you were in the FBI, and Mr. Richard, all of you. The why now, Mr. Sage testified yesterday from the FBI that the their office, their decisions, the FBI's decisions, were not driven by fatigue or frustration. I think that was Wednesday he actually said that. But yet, in reading the Attorney General's statement that she gave to the FBI after this, she indicates, Mr. Hubble, that I'm quoting from the 302 statement, Hubble was convinced from his conversation with the negotiator, and I assume that's Mr. Sage, that David Koresh was not coming out. Koresh had not fulfilled any of his promises at that point to do anything he said he would. People were getting tired. Negotiators were tired, and tempers were fraying. At that point, I'm wondering if this is the justification, the reasoning why the FBI, and I've heard child abuse, but you know those allegations have been going on for years, and I've heard now health and sanitary conditions, which, you know, while that's significant, I can't imagine that being a real reason to go in with the type of force that they did. It sounds like something we thought of afterwards. And I've heard of the fact that maybe negotiations had broken down and those kind of things, but I'm like the Attorney General. Why not wait? And I have some concern about maybe it was, as you said, Mr. Clark, and I respect your opinion and your experience and the FBI, but things were stressful. And I understand that. I appreciate that fact. I'm not criticizing it. But when you look at all the factors together, why was that factor, the fatigue, the stress, the fraying nerves, the temper, even, like I said, tempers were fraying. Was that the primary driving force for that decision being made?
Mr. Bryant, so far as I can tell, you've heard the earlier reference to the quality of the hostage rescue team and its capabilities. There was discussion at that time about their coming to the edge and needing to go back, retrain, and to do those things which kept them in the state of preparedness. The things they do require practice and require constant attention to it. And that was one of the factors. Obviously, fatigue on all those people was very great. So there were a number of things that were discussed about what was the situation there at the time. And it was discussed on a continuing basis, with certainly within the FBI and so far as I know and believe with the Attorney General. She was aware of those things.
But anyway, I think I've got one other person. One other person might ask him, Mr. Richard.
Thank you, Congressman Bryant. As I recall, the question of why now rose subsequent to the initial briefing of the Attorney General on, I believe, April 12th, during a meeting after the briefing by the FBI, which was held in the Attorney General's office. And it was a question that we discussed. What has changed that would suggest that we must move now? I think that was a question on the table for several days, and I can't speak for the Attorney General in her thought processes, but certainly I began to answer the question for myself after participating in the discussion with the FBI negotiator, Sage, and realized that negotiations, at least as viewed by the FBI, were now fruitless. There was an anticipation that they would not be productive. And this did suggest that our options were severely constricted. But that, those are my views, and I can't speak for the Attorney General.
Thank you, Mr. Bryant. Mr. Scott, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Judge Sessoms, over the weekend, Senator Bradley, on a morning news show, related the story about an African-American Harvard law student who was stopped and handcuffed for no apparent reason. He was released after he convinced the police officers that he was a Harvard law student and wasn't doing anything wrong. You're aware that the exclusionary rule protects innocent people from these kinds of indignities, and I'm sure you're aware of other examples, because it removes all incentives that a law enforcement officer may have to break the law. Because if he stops someone without probable cause, without a warrant, he knows that he can't use whatever evidence he may pick up. Thus far in these hearings, we've heard that the exclusionary rule is the only effective tool to deal with police misconduct and virtually the only forum in which you can even discuss it. We've heard from law enforcement officers that they don't need relief from their duty to obey the law. They don't need to make illegal searches, and they don't need a watered-down exclusionary rule in order to perform their duties. Mr. Sessoms, do you see any reason that the exclusionary rule should be watered down further to excuse and encourage police misconduct?
Mr. Scott, I heard the statements that were made by the senator, and I, of course, had very direct contact for many, many years with Fourth Amendment rights and the exclusionary rule and the impact on law enforcement. I can remember back in the 1960s when Messiah and Escobedo and Miranda, those great cases which established constitutional principles, were hammered out. And what we found was that law enforcement reacted positively. Law enforcement reacted in a fashion to make it even more competent and make it more professional in every respect, to be able to abide the law and to perform their activities under the Constitution. This is critical. Law enforcement can meet that standard and should be required to meet that standard, and it should be part and parcel of everything they carry with them. To not have to have a good faith exception, to not have to have an exception in any way that would require them to lessen their standard of professionalism. So I believe very strongly that the Fourth Amendment is what it says, and that in fact we should not weaken it, and that we should bring up our law enforcement standards to meet the highest standard that's required by the Constitution and the law.
Thank you. Mr. Hubble, earlier in these hearings we heard from Mr. Noble and Mr. McGaw. It's clear from their testimony that the ATF ambush was the fault of David Koresh and some of his followers. But they also went to great lengths to point out that mistakes had been made, and if they had to do it over again, they had pinpointed mistakes that they had made, and there, we have a level of comfort that if they had to do it again, the chances that four law enforcement officers would be killed in the process is greatly diminished. We heard earlier that we knew that there was a chance when we went in that children would die as a result of the final invasion. You saw what happened. What did you think would happen? And can we give the American public some level of comfort that children don't have to die when you're trying to execute an arrest warrant and a search warrant?
If you're talking about the 19th, I don't think there's a person on this panel that hasn't gone over what we would do again if we had to do it over again.
The 19th is the final.
The 19th is the final. Final. We were not involved in the initial ATF service of the warrant. I'm not that familiar with what happened. I am aware that we had great concerns because there was a leak to the press and ultimately a leak to Vernon Howell or David Koresh. But certainly, if we knew what we knew was going to happen, we would try to find another way. And we think about it, I know I do, every day.
Mr. Salem, It's my understanding that if children are exposed to CS gas, that they will be very much traumatized. It's also my understanding that you have no citation of any medical implications that would last more than 30 days for someone for a child exposed to CS gas, even though the gas is used on a widespread basis over many years. Is that accurate?
I'm sorry?
Is that an accurate statement?
Yes, sir.
Your expertise is in physical irritation. Do you have any expertise in the psychological reaction to the gas so that you would be able to predict what someone would do? That is not your expertise?
No, sir.
Is there anything else you wanted to add in response to the question from the gentlelady from Florida in response to misstatements that were made yesterday?
Yes, I was hoping that she would be here. Can we wait until she gets back? Or
she will. She's probably looking at it on the monitor. So,
okay. Some of the things that I would like to mention. These hearings are in search of the truth and the facts. I can't recall from yesterday's meeting about the misinformation, but some of the information that I heard from the previous evening on the effects of CS, which I'd like to clarify. First of all, I'd like to say that it is the safest and most effective alternative that we do know of. And I concur completely with what the British expert said on the CS. The causes of the reports that deaths have occurred following the use of CS, on investigation, the facts show that other materials were used. For example, in one case that was mentioned, CN was used in combination with CS, and we know that deaths have occurred from the use of CN. In that same case, when that case came to trial, the conclusion was that they felt that the individual who died was actually suffocated. In another case where they talked about the deaths following CS in the West Bank in Israel, the GAO did a report to Congressman Dellums back in 1988, I believe it was, and Physicians for Human Rights went there to do the investigation, and they could not find any confirmed deaths following the use due to CS, nor any miscarriages that were reported. The GAO said that perhaps there were four deaths, but that was due to tear gas, and they didn't specify which one it was. And then there's another report from the director of the Palestine Human Rights Campaign, who concluded that Israel used two types of riot control agents, CN and CS, but they generally used CN. The other fact that I heard that occurred the other night was that suffocation was caused by the dust settling. These are very small particulates, and if they settle, they settle because these particles agglomerate, become bigger, and then fall to the ground. They don't hover just above the surface. The more realistic happening is probably that these particles were blown out by the wind and the circulation. We've heard that lungs blister following the use of CS. CS is an irritant. It causes irritation and inflammation, and possibly pulmonary edema may result. However, in my experience, I have not seen where lungs actually blister internally. The other fact I'd like to clarify is that children are more likely to have a greater capacity to breathe CS. Yes, their respiratory rate is higher than it is in adults. However, as you inhale, you also exhale. And if the particles don't impact on the respiratory tract, some of them are blown out. So if you're breathing faster, you're probably breathing out more of it. The other important factor is not the breathing rate, but it's the minute volume, which is the volume times the rate of breathing. And children have a smaller minute volume than adults do. So that they would probably breathe in less.
Thank you, Mr. Scott. Your time has expired. Mr. Zelop, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Dr. Salem, just a quick yes or no answer. Is CS gas safer than waiting? That's okay.
Well, it depends on the definition of waiting, what would occur then.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Sessions, you were the head of the FBI for both events that took place on the 28th of February as well as the 19th of April?
That's correct.
And tell me about your involvement with the gas plan. When it was presented initially by the FBI internally from the bottom up, I guess, dated March 27th. At what point did you connect, and at what point did you get involved, and at what point did you make your decision when you thought it was a good idea?
I don't recall the precise date that came to me, Mr. Zelop, but it came as an alternative possibility. You'll recall you were mentioning back both at the first date and the last date. You'll remember that on February 16th, the World Trade Center went up, and on February 18th, ATF went into the compound with the resultant deaths. From that point on, there were constant discussions about things that could be done to bring it to a conclusion, most particularly that related to negotiation and try to find ways that it could actually be negotiated down and out.
Right.
And some of those plans were labeled as ridiculous. Some of them were labeled as not practical, but though we were discussing all these things, including ultimately the use of gas.
Right. Who brought it to you?
I would presume that it came either through Mr. Potts or through Mr. Clark. I do not recall precisely. We met repeatedly in the command center in the FBI daily, so that where precisely it came, where precisely it was first discussed, I don't recall.
Thank you. Mr. Sessions, FBI agent Smerick testified here under oath that he changed his thinking. He changed his judgment in a fifth and final memo, and based on a sense that he needed to please you. I believe this last memo was April 9th, and he went from favoring negotiation to shifting away from negotiation to the gas plan. Just give me your comment on, I mean, is this...
I would have to probably comment at length, Mr.
I had a real problem with that myself.
Well, I do not know that that's what he said. If he said it was to please me, that is one thing. I don't know that he said that.
Okay.
If he said it was to please others within the Bureau, that might well have been. My own belief stems from back dealing with the riots at Oakdale and Atlanta and Talladega and all these things that we've dealt with, and patience and waiting, as you mentioned, is a very important factor. I can remember Mike Quinlan, the director of the Bureau of Prisons, saying that he will wait forever, but negotiation is an important part of it.
And you pushed that.
I pushed it both personally, individually, in discussions every time we turned around, in terms of the actual operation on the ground.
Just
yes,
to be
sir.
Clear, in no way did you get Mr. Smerick to change his writing of his memo, change his thinking so it would agree with yours.
That could not be. Well, if he said that he believed in continuing negotiation and work at negotiation, then he would reflect my views.
Okay.
He did not write that memo to please me. Now, there may have been others that he did, but certainly not me.
Mr. Sessions, did you know that the Texas Rangers and Koresh's lawyers had brought to Mr. Jamara's attention a surrender plan that they worked out with Koresh on April 14th? And don't you think you should have known about that plan? Did you know about that plan?
Are you referring to the plan that relates to his writing on the seven seals?
That's correct.
And the completion of that?
Of the writing?
I was aware of that, yes. I was not aware. Somebody phrased it a surrender plan. He had talked many times about coming out. We had brought out many, many people from the beginning. Then those people stopped coming. And there was a great difficulty in relying on anything he said, but I was aware, of course,
so they let you know as a result. And I'm sorry, I just
that he was in that he was in the compound. That is, that the lawyer was in the compound. This, again, was an effort to be sure that we left no stone unturned to bring those people out alive.
Okay, and the next day he spoke to you, Mr. Hubble, for 2 hours. What did he tell you about the surrender plan?
He who?
Or the whatever kind of plan you want to call it.
I don't know who I learned from about the fact that Vernon Howell or David Koresh was saying that after he interpreted the seven seals and wrote about the seven seals, that he was willing to come out. I don't know who told me that, whether it was first heard it from Mr. Clark or Mr. Potts or Mr. Sage, or there were constant discussions going on. I was aware that that was the latest discussion that was being had with the people inside the compound. I can't tell you precisely when I learned it, but I was aware of it.
There are three or four things that are missing that you could be personally helpful for with us. We're missing some of your telephone logs, particularly April 17th, 18th, and 19th, and our problem is that they've all been redacted. And is there any chance that we could get those? And then there's testimony in a Whitewater hearing that you kept certain files in your basement. Additionally, the Department of Justice has told you that you kept separate Waco files. Did you ever or did you know if you have Waco files in your basement or in your possession anywhere that could be helpful? And could we get some information on filling in these three vital days? What's happened to us in trying to bring this information out, this is important for us. The missing tape on February 28th is very important to us that ATF doesn't have. They got all arrests, but that one's missing. I mean, there's just some of this stuff that would be vital in terms of letting us try to figure this all out. Can you be helpful on this?
I can be helpful. Nobody's ever asked me, but I have a copy of these same logs, and you're welcome to them as far as I'm concerned. Except, I have to tell you, the 17th and 18th were and Saturday 19th. And Sunday. And so, therefore, there wouldn't be any. These are basically logs of people who called and left a message for me to call them back. Not necessarily everybody I talked
primarily
to.
Primarily, what we're looking for is any discussions you had prior to the 19th, obviously in those 3 days, relative to anybody, whether it be the president, whether it be FBI or anybody else.
I have no trouble giving you my logs for those days, if
Great.
You want
Thank
them.
Thank you.
Mr. Schumer, your time is, Mr. Zeloff, your time has expired. Mr. Schumer, I'm going to recognize you.
I was thinking ahead a little bit there. Mr. Schumer, you're recognized.
Right. Quit while you're ahead. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And I would like to direct a few questions to you, Mr. Hubble, aimed at what I consider the charitably fishing expedition parts of the allegations out there, more like a witch hunt. I want to put to rest some things because there are all sorts of again, conspiracy theories, some politically motivated to tie the president or the White House into pushing ahead the formula for going in prematurely for some for nefarious reasons, some because the president saw it was day 49, day 50, day 51, and he was anxious to get it over with. All of this I have not seen one scrap of evidence, one scrap. That indicates that. So I want to ask you clearly, Mr. Hubble, did President Clinton convey to you in any way, shape, or form that he wanted the siege at the Branch Davidian compound ended, and to you, and that you or Attorney General Reno should make that end happen? In other words, ended before she or the Justice Department officials thought it was appropriate. In other words, did the President impose pressure on the decision-making process about Waco, yes or no?
No, he did not, either directly or indirectly.
Any at all? Anything that might be even interpreted as that?
No, he did not.
No winks of an eye or shimmy of the hips or anything like that?
No, he did not.
Okay, and let me ask you this. Did you, now we've talked about the president, did you convey on your own? Now, you were a justice, but you're a good friend of the president, so maybe that implicates him somehow. So did you convey on your own any desire to get the siege at Waco over? In other words, did you pressure the Attorney General to prematurely move up the decision?
No, I did not.
And are you aware of any official at the White House who would pressure the Attorney General or the Justice Department to move up that decision before it was ripe, before it was ready to happen?
No, they did not. I am confident no one at the White House attempted in any way to influence the decision of the Attorney General.
Okay. Now, we have four other gentlemen here who are at the top levels of the FBI, in the high command of the decision-making process. I would like to ask each of the other gentlemen the same question. Did President Clinton or any other high official in the White House pressure you gentlemen to make a decision to move in before you thought it was appropriate? And you could please answer yes or no. Judge Sessions?
Mr. Schumer, I had no contact in the White House at all.
Mr. Potts?
No, sir.
Mr. Richard?
No contact with the White
Mr.
House.
Clark?
None.
Okay. Now, I know what's going to happen here. You're going to get lots of nitpicking. They're going to say phone logs. They're going to say some, you know, this or that or the other thing, and make little implications that sort of hang out there with no factual basis. But again, please search your memories. Do any of you, the people at the highest levels of justice, with the exception of the Attorney General, and I'll ask her the same question, have any feeling at all, even a feeling that happened to pop into your head, that the White House, that President Clinton, pushed you into making a decision you didn't want to make? Please just answer again. No, says Mr. Hubble.
No,
says Judge Sessions. No, shakes his head, Mr. Potts.
No, sir.
No, says Mr. Richard.
Absolutely.
And absolutely not, says Mr. Clark. You guys have, for one point of time, I'm out of questions here. Gosh, no, it's too precious. I think I will. In the interest of moving things ahead, I will yield back my time.
Well, I've already recognized Mr. Zeloff. Who's next? Ileana Ross Layton. Ms. Layton.
Chairman, to Mr. Zeloff.
Mr. Hubble. I was in the process. We talked about the phone logs, and we appreciate it. If we could get those fairly quick, that would be helpful.
If you would just have a member of your staff let me know who
thank you.
Wants them.
Actually, Bobby Charles would be good.
Okay.
And the other thing is that we talked about, Rhoda, for the Whitewater hearing, that you kept files in your basement and other places. Additionally, the Department of Justice has told us that you keep separate Waco files. Is there any chance that we could have access to some of them?
You can have access to any files that I have, Congressman. I do have my own set of Waco files, and you're welcome to them, or copies of them.
Thank you.
Okay.
That's great. Let me ask you, in terms of the gas plan yourself, when did you make your mind up that you felt that this was a good plan?
I was, we were discussing it up until the Saturday that the Attorney General made the final decision. It was a very difficult decision to make. We went through every option imaginable, even some crazy ones that I had. But so I probably made up my mind about the same time the Attorney General did on Saturday. Although I admit that on that I think it was Saturday or maybe Friday, the decision was no go, even that late.
Well, what pushed you over? What made it happen in your mind?
I think it's a combination of factors. I think the evaluation done by the military of the plan.
What did the military say?
Military evaluated the plan at length in front of the Attorney General and myself and others, and as well as Floyd and others, and Judge Sessions. They only had one slight disagreement with the plan.
What was that?
That was that they would go in with the gas totally at first, as opposed to a partial insertion into one area. I believe they felt like that you should go in totally all at once. They also said that their experience, they weren't limited by the rules of engagement that the FBI had. That they might...
Were there rules of engagement by the FBI? What were they?
Yes, they were. That they would not shoot unless someone's life was in danger.
Mm-hmm.
And the military would have done what else? They probably would have taken Koresh out.
They didn't say that directly, but you certainly had that impression if it were on foreign soil and these people were being held as hostages.
So on foreign soil, we would have taken them out.
I think you really need to ask the military, but I think that would be something that they would certainly...
They would have gone in and gotten rid of the place real quick. I mean, that's kind of a quick summation, isn't it?
I think you really... That's a quick summation of a long day.
Well, I guess the problem that I have is what pushed you over? When did you make the decision? Was it the military's recommendations that pushed you over?
I think it was a combination of what pushed us all over. It was not only the military saying that the plan was a good plan and it would work. The military said they will come out of that building. I mean, I had a general and a colonel both look me in the eye and say, they can't stay in that building. They will come out immediately. That was part of it. Part of it was the factor that in the near future, it was likely that we would have to change the deployment of the hostage rescue team.
Right.
Not immediately, but in the near future. The factor of that there were people trying to get into the compound and there was danger to the FBI agents. That was a factor.
Let me ask you one other question, and I have one for Mr. Sessions. Do you know whether there's any document or conversation that would indicate that the White House and not the Attorney General would be the final entity that approved any significant decision at Waco, including the CS gas decision?
I have no such document.
Mr. Hart?
I'm not aware of any document like that, no.
Nothing at all that said the President would have the final decision, nothing would be done, you know, without his approval. You know of no documents?
No document like that at all.
Okay. And Mr. Sessions, same kind of questions, if you would. When did you make up your mind that the gas plan is a good idea, and what put you over the edge? Probably not a good phrase to use, but what made you come to grips with this is the right thing to do?
Well, the whole plan was to be able to extract those people and have them come out safely. Everybody's mind was the same on that point. The question was how to do it and how to work it. And you know and you can see that there was a constantly tightening ring around that group. And the insertion of the gas on the ends of the compounds was perceived as a means by which you could get them constricted even further.
Right.
And ultimately they would know that they were simply going to have to come out, that it was not an environment where they could actually continue to live. You'll have to remember, people had long since ceased coming out, and Mr. Koresh had no longer allowed people to come out.
You were trying to
tighten the ring.
I can see the chairman's getting nervous with the flipper.
Your time has expired. I'm not getting that nervous. Mr. Watt, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I thank these members of the panel for being here today. To the extent that... I have felt that these hearings have served any useful or valuable purpose. I have tried to do it in the context of what kind of prospective guidance what has happened in the past might provide to us, rather than making an effort to second guess each and every aspect. And we've succeeded, particularly Mr. Scott and I, in getting some educational benefit and prospective value placed on personal and civil rights and the value of the exclusionary rule and the Fourth Amendment rights that are protected. And I think some concessions have been made that the ATF probably stepped across some lines or were very close to lines in those areas, and that there are some things that we might be able to do in the future to better safeguard individual rights and liberties. And I spent some time asking Secretary Benson about the administrative supervisory chain of command guidelines and what knowledge that this incident might bring to bear on changes, and I understand that some administrative changes have been made to try to improve the supervisory lines. I'm interested particularly from Judge Sessoms, and I think I may have asked this question to Mr. Potts on a prior panel, so I won't ask him to address it again, but I'm especially interested in what kind of lessons informed by what transpired at Waco, what kind of changes you think need to be made, whether they have or have not been made, in the administrative functionings that the decision-making processes that lead to the decisions in these kind of settings, such as Waco, and whether there are any personal rights, individual rights lessons that you might bring to bear, and whether there are any other than individual and administrative lessons that we might gain from Waco. My effort being to try to use this as something to inform us to be a better nation in the future rather than simply trying to second guess on Monday morning the plays that took place on that fateful day.
Mr. Watt, in responding to Mr. Scott's question, I made it very clear about my strong feeling that's compatible with what you've expressed, that is, the certainty that the Fourth Amendment of the Constitution of the United States remain intact, and that, in fact, we do those things which are compatible with being sure that it does. That means training, that means professionalism, that means taking those things which will assure that all law enforcement people understand the importance of those rights and that right. Patience is probably the greatest virtue you could have in connection with this kind of circumstance. I mentioned the circumstances at Oakdale, Louisiana, when that prison had the riots, at Atlanta when it had the riots, at Talladega when it had the riots. Everywhere we've been, it's important to have patience, but also to negotiate, and to not leave unturned any possible negotiating possibility. And there were negotiating possibilities from the beginning down in Waco. Everybody knows that I had contact directly from people associated with Mr. Koresh about the possibility of my going down and negotiating with them, coming in down there. Now, some people played that as ridiculous and ridiculed it, or as grandstanding, but it's indicative of what I felt and continue to feel. You can't discard any possibility that you can resolve that kind of circumstance when you can take and apply that negotiating capability. So the negotiation is obviously very, very important. Pressure, which is what you've seen demonstrated so repeatedly in connection with Waco, is also important. So pressure, negotiating, and patience are those three things. Now, administratively, to translate those into an active and effective function, you have to have continual discussion. And in fact, we had that day in and day out, and it went as high as the Attorney General. Where it went from there, I do not know. But the point is that those elements were there. I do not believe that we were served well by discarding any of those negotiating possibilities. Acting Attorney General Gerson discarded those as being not appropriate for the director to become involved in. I can understand why not. You don't want any person who is barricaded to know that they can trigger the arrival of the director of the FBI to do that. And yet this was no normal circumstance. This had the same approximate number of people that were captive down in Atlanta. And there again, the point was patience and negotiate, endlessly keep after it and patiently keep after it. It is important.
Before my time expires, Secretary Benson testified at the hearings here about some administrative chain of command changes that have been made to bring a closer level of supervision from the Department of Treasury over the ATF agents. Are you familiar with those, and do you care to comment on whether the chain of command was clear enough in ATF to Treasury and the changes that took place in response?
Mr. Watt, I am not familiar with what Secretary Benson discussed, nor the chain of command of Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms. I am clear on the chain of command within the Bureau and know that it functions and functions well. You always have to have a clear line channel and a willingness to actually report those things that are happening. And it's very clear that that you must have it, and so ATF would be well advised to do whatever is necessary to get it if they don't have it.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Watt. Mr. Schiff, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I would like to yield all of my time to Chairman Zeliff, please.
Thank you. I want to go back to you, Mr. Hubbell, if you could. We talked about written correspondence. Any conversations, verbal, any written or verbal, any discussions, anything you can remember from February 28th to April 19th indicating that the President had an interest in being involved in what's going on? Any changes to the negotiation process, anything that you can remember relative to all the things that were happening from February 28th to April 19th?
I was aware, Chairman, that the President wanted to be advised if there was any change in the posture in Waco from the decision to negotiate and therefore when the decision to insert the gas, although considered by some to be continued negotiations, we felt like we needed to advise the President of the insertion of the gas.
So if I understand you correctly, he wanted to be involved. He wanted to know if anything changed from the negotiation process. And whether it was you or Mr. Lindsay, or Mr. Nussbaum, Mr. McCarty, or others, however he got all that information formally or informally, he wanted to be included in the loop. Am I correct?
I was told by Attorney General Gerson that the President wanted to be advised if there was going to be any change.
Right. Am I right in understanding then that he wanted to be involved in the decision-making process?
I didn't consider it that. I think he wanted to be advised if there was going to be a change, and we did so.
Sounds like Mr. Altman's letter to Mr. Benson, you know, he wrote on April 15th that something tragic was going to happen on the 19th, and we ought to, you know, in his judgment, somebody ought to stop it. Mr. Benson said, well, that was the FBI's problem. That shifts me over to you, Mr. Sessions. Are you the guy that really, I mean, you know, bring it on down? If Janet Reno wanted to, she can just say, well, I was just following Mr. Sessions' recommendation. I mean, at what point do we assign responsibility for this thing?
Well, you can assign it wherever you feel it's appropriate, Mr. Chairman, but the discussions with the Attorney General were very complete, and she was very, very interested in every single phase and step of it and questioned how the decisions were made. She was particularly concerned about children, and we all know that. She was concerned that if a child was held up in a window, that anything that was being done should immediately be stopped if there was any indication of a child being endangered. She was very interested all the way along. You can assign it where you want. My responsibility was to direct the FBI. The Attorney General, of course, is the director, overseer of the director of the FBI.
But you were the director of the FBI.
That's correct.
Certainly, as far as the FBI is concerned and the plan itself, you had to be part of that responsibility.
That is correct.
And then she, at her level, had to be part of that responsibility.
That's correct.
And probably someone above her had to be part of that responsibility.
I think the Attorney General has the full authority to do exactly what she did, that is to approve and order and direct me to proceed with the plan that had been presented to her.
Dr. Salem, you mentioned that the GAO report on CS gas available long before Waco, of course, and you showed it as one example that the CS gas was not harmful. Are you aware that the State Department disagreed with you? And let me just read and insert this in the record if I can, Mr. Chairman. This is a GAO report, and that's dated April of 1989.
According to State's Human Rights Report to Congress, figures compiled from press, Palestinian and Israeli government sources indicate that 366 Palestinians were killed in 1988 as a result of the uprising. While exact figures are unavailable and estimates vary, State Department reported that at least four deaths resulted from tear gas used by the IDF, the Israeli Defense Forces, in the enclosed areas. You are aware of that?
Yes, sir. I stated that, I believe, in my remarks that there were four deaths attributed to tear gas, but they didn't specify that that was CS. And the other report said that the Israelis were using both CN and CS.
Okay, so it was inconclusive. At least I can say that there was inconclusive evidence, but there's certainly some evidence, whether it was conclusive or not, that it could be harmful?
Yes, sir.
Okay, and also in the Ruby Ridge Marshall's log, and again, I'd just like to bring this up, maybe Mr. Potts would comment on this again. They indicated, and we inserted in the record yesterday, that the use of CS gas would be harmful to children, particularly children. And I believe Mr. Potts indicated that they did not feel that this was credible. I guess my same question there, credible or not, it certainly indicates that there's a potential harm to children. Mr. Potts.
Yes, sir.
And also Dr. Salem, if you would, afterwards.
All chemicals are potentially harmful. It depends on the amount and the way it's used, sir.
Okay. Mr. Potts?
Yes, sir. A couple of things. One, I understand that the marshal out in Idaho at that time has indicated that he called that back and that...
That's good judgment, I guess. Do you feel that was good judgment? That he called it back?
Yes, sir, that's fine, but he indicated that he did not indicate that it was a high risk, that's not an accurate reflection
He changed his mind?
No, sir, he just indicated that he did not say it was a high risk. He did indicate that it was a risk to children. Sir, I think it's also important to note in that log that it doesn't say CS gas. It just says gas. I understand, I was not on the site there, but I understand that there were other types of gases that were discussed out there. Yeah. Now, I can't tell you that this comment does or does not refer to CS, but there were other types of gas that were discussed at Ruby Ridge other than CS.
Mr. Zeloff, your time is up. Mr. Conyers, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Gentlemen, the question has been raised more than once across the years that alcohol, tobacco, and firearms ought to be folded into the Federal Bureau of Investigation. Can I find out if there's anybody that's open to that suggestion on the panel? Mr. Clark, Mr. Richard, Mr. Potts, Mr. Hubble, Judge Sessions? Okay. Two opens? Mr. Clark, you're open to that. Would you give me a brief comment, please?
Well, I think it can't be a simple answer of whether you're open to it or not. I do think that there are issues of coordination within federal law enforcement, and that is an option. But I think those areas are viable discussion topics. Mm-hmm. So I think those areas are open for discussion.
Well, what's your case for after we open the discussion and become viable? Then we say, let's put the firearms responsibility of ATF into the FBI. Where do you come down there?
Well, I think my concerns are a little bit different than just where you place the responsibility. My concerns are things like Attorney General guidelines for undercover operations, Attorney General guidelines for the use of Title III's. Those kinds of things vary from law enforcement agency to law enforcement agency. And I think that there is a need for continuity in the way that the federal government exercises its federal law enforcement responsibility. However that is done, I'm open to discussion. Consolidating functions and responsibilities certainly is one option.
Well, bringing them all together, it seems to me, would increase the likelihood of continuity.
Yes, it would.
Deputy Assistant Attorney General, Richard, could you give me a brief observation on this, please?
Yes, and I'll be only speaking on a personal basis because I don't necessarily reflect the views of the department. Frankly, Congressman, I believe it's imperative that the Attorney General be recognized not just in name but in function as the chief law enforcement officer over all law enforcement agencies, and in that capacity have the ability to ensure uniformity of procedures and adequate coordination of all functions to avoid inefficiencies, duplication, and problems with respect to processes of critical importance. So I agree that there is much that can be done. But on the other hand, to bring the entire agency within the department in the context of your suggesting, I suspect may be inappropriate given their vast regulatory and administrative responsibilities that are also assigned to ATF.
Mm-hmm. Judge Sessions.
Mr. Conyers, there are several aspects to that that could take us many days to discuss, but briefly, two things have to be considered, and that is the gathering of a great deal of law enforcement power into one agency. There was discussion almost immediately after the raid by ATF that they ought to be incorporated into the FBI.
And I thought it was almost accomplished. It was at one rife, time I was waiting for the press release.
It was rife all over this town. The gathering of that power, however, is very difficult if you look at what can happen. Right now, their responsibility is over an area that is highly political. The Bureau tries to maintain itself apolitically, and certainly I tried to the best of my ability to keep political considerations out of the Bureau's business. If you actually incorporate that ATF function into the Department of Justice, with all of the political concerns that it has, and you have a political Attorney General who is a member of the Cabinet, you have some problems that you might not be able to deal with effectively. And to boot, you've got the problem of gathering so much power into the FBI, and I think that needs to be looked at very, very carefully.
Well, I'll be cautious as we continue to look at it, but, you know, examine with me the fact that the Attorney General already has 95% of all law enforcement power in the country anyway, and is attacked politically on a very regular basis. So, you know, what's new? That's the way this business goes down. What I want to do is stop having all of the fights that go on between law enforcement agencies, the Drug Enforcement Agency, FBI, the Secret Service sometimes, INS, all have legal capacities that unless they're really regulated by one central authority, I think we have a problem. Now, let me go on to the question about the President's involvement, Mr. Hubbell. Was the President's decision to leave this to the experts and that he wanted to be consulted, or was he involved in making the decisions? To what extent, where does the line come down in that area?
It's my understanding that the President wanted to be advised if the strategy from pure negotiation changed. And the Attorney General did that in a conversation on the 18th, and I kept the White House counsels advised as the week prior to that about the possibility of the plan. I am not aware that the President ever said, I want to be involved in the decision, or that I have some ideas about this. Finally, he wanted to be advised.
Finally, how come everybody here is for the Fourth Amendment and the exclusionary rule, and the administration isn't? Can you explain that to me? I have all of these great protestations of support for constitutional process, and then when we get to the administration and the Attorney General, we have two sets of testimony here. You can only speak for yourselves, but We're having some serious erosions of the exclusionary rule in the anti-terrorist legislation. And what does it mean? We have everybody here. There hasn't been one witness during these 5 or 6 days that wasn't for strengthening the exclusionary rule. The attorneys, the government, all witnesses. But so what does that leave us with? Mr. Richard?
Mr. Conyers, can I respond and take exception to at least a portion of your remark? And that is, this Attorney General in the Department of Justice is very much committed to defense of Fourth Amendment liberties. Our positions, as reflected in the anti-terrorism bill and the like, in our judgment, are consistent with Fourth Amendment obligations. And we strongly endorse.
You mean this. Eroding the exclusionary rule is consistent with supporting the Fourth Amendment?
As you know, the administration and the Department of Justice has a variety of concerns in this area and has expressed it during the course of this legislation. But I'm just suggesting that with respect to other aspects that are in the anti-terrorism bill and the like, we do believe that they are consistent and supportive of our concerns regarding.
Well, I'd like to just show you some of the testimony that we've had here that I'm not putting words in anybody's mouth or making up anything. This is a very serious problem, a division of position within this administration that at least we should do is acknowledge the positions that are at opposition within the administration. And I'm putting nothing in anybody's mouth. That's what I'm trying to solve, as a matter of fact. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Conyers. Mr. Coble, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
I'm not going to use all my time. Gentlemen, good to have you all here with us. I want to just make a brief statement, Mr. Chairman. Some folks have questioned whether or not these hearings have been useful and valuable. Well, use and value may be subject to interpretation, but I think there's no doubt, Mr. Chairman, that these hearings will have been determined to have served a good and useful purpose. Now, having said that, Mr. Chairman, I think you have questions you wanted to pursue. So having said that, I will yield the balance of my time to you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Coble. Mr. Hubble, a few minutes ago, you responded by saying that in the meeting with the military, which I believe took place on the 14th of April with the Attorney General, that they indicated or said very strongly that they believe that if the tear gas, the CS gas, was inserted, that the people would come out. I mean, you made that a very forceful statement. Is that correct?
That is correct.
Did you know at that time, were you aware at that time, that the Davidians in the compound had gas masks?
I believe we were aware they had gas masks, yes. We assumed they had gas masks.
And the military said they'd come out anyway?
Yes, they did.
All right. Were you aware of something that came up yesterday? Mr. Jamar told us in testimony yesterday that he was 99% certain in his own mind that if these CVs went up with the gas to insert it, that they would be fired upon, and that the plan called for the acceleration of the gas and not just over a lengthy period of time at that juncture. And in response to my question to Mr. Potts about that, he indicated yesterday he was unaware of Mr. Jamar's feelings about this, unaware that this was a likelihood, and obviously the clear implication of that is that probably you would accelerate, that the idea of a long extended period of inserting this gas would not take place. Were you aware through any source, obviously not Mr. Potts, that Mr. Jamar felt that there would be a 99% likelihood that these vehicles would be fired upon and that the insertion of that gas would have to come in an accelerated fashion?
I was not aware that Mr. Jamar felt like there was a 99% chance it would happen. I think certainly, at least I did, and I believe others did, believe that that was a possibility because they prepared for that contingency
by saying
that if it did happen, they were going to accelerate the plan.
I understand that, but if you knew that it was going to happen in all probability as opposing to just a possibility, would that have affected your recommendation, your thoughts, your discussions with the Attorney General, or do you believe it would have affected anybody else's who met with her with regard to this in the final day or two?
I believe it was being considered
during that entire time that that was, I believed, a likelihood that the vehicles would be fired upon when they attempted to insert the gas. So I believe that that was not only a likelihood, but was had to be taken into consideration as everybody made their individual decisions.
Let me ask you one other question. You talked to Mr. Sage on the telephone on a two-hour conference call on April 15th, the day after this meeting with the military, according to the Justice Department report. It also, according to that report, you talked with him because the Attorney General asked you to get more information, I presume. Is that not true?
That is correct. The Attorney General wanted me to talk personally with the head negotiator to go over everything that had happened, to get his opinion of whether Koresh was going to come out and anytime soon, whether he could be negotiated out, and what had happened, and what his prediction was going to happen.
And what did Mr. Sage, in general terms, in 2 hours, say to you?
In general terms, that the negotiations had failed, that he could not negotiate Vernon Howe, David Koresh, out of the building, or anyone else, that the only people who had left that building left because David Koresh wanted them to.
Did Mr. Sage at any time during that conversation mention the names to you of DeGaron, Zimmerman, or Arnold?
We did discuss the... I can't tell you where the first time I learned, I think I knew before that, about the attorneys, but we did discuss the attorneys, the seven seals with Mr. Sage. Yes.
Well, what I want to know is, did he at any time say that Mr. DeGaron, with the help of religion experts, was working on a new approach with Koresh that might be fruitful, and that that approach was one which involved the persuasion of Koresh to come out because DeGaron believed that Koresh had now become convinced he was a messenger of God rather than to be a martyr under the seven seals, and that indeed if given about 10 days in time, DeGaron was absolutely convinced that Koresh would indeed come out. Did that explicitly get conveyed to you by Mr. Sage?
He conveyed to me the conversations with Mr. DeGaron. He did not convey to me that he thought the plan would work. In fact, he indicated to me that it wouldn't, the attorneys were being manipulated by Mr. Koresh.
He indicated they were being manipulated by Koresh, and that therefore, did he convey to you, though, the concept that the attorneys presented, that the idea that Koresh was now viewing himself as the messenger rather than the martyr, and that that was a very important thing in the view of the attorneys as a big change in Koresh and their rationale for why Koresh now, they believed, would come out because he had had a change of perspective under his interpretation of these seals. Did you get into that kind of detail discussion?
I got into a lot of detail, but I certainly didn't understand what you've just said to be the case. I understood based on my conversation with Mr. Sage, and I can't recall everything that was said, that Mr. Koresh was manipulating the attorneys to buy more time and that he wasn't going to come out. I did not ever get the impression that there had been a shift in Mr. Koresh's view of himself at all.
Thank you very much. Who am I going to next on your side? Mr. Lantos, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Most of my colleagues quite properly have been dealing with the details and the particulars of this episode. I would like to deal with the broad picture. I'd like to address you, Judge Sessions. There are few people in American public life in recent decades who have had your experience and your integrity in dealing with American society. I'd like to ask you to sit back a bit and look at this episode in a broad historic and conceptual framework. It has seemed to me all along that three approaches have emerged concerning this tragedy. The first, to which the lunatic fringe still adheres with great tenacity, is that this whole Waco tragedy was the result of a conspiratorial government attempting to destroy the American people's right to religious freedom and the American people's right to bear arms. I'd like to ask you to react to this approach.
Mr. Lantos, I think you're very perceptive. And going back to the very roots of our society, from the very beginning, we were a different people. We had different drummers that we marched to. The people on the Mayflower were in grave disagreement with their church authorities and with their government. America became, in the whole world, the one place where people could disagree with their government. And finally, with our Constitution, we nailed that down and said it was the most important of factors in society in America. So it is tremendously important that the government not be perceived as conspiring against its people, and it must not do that. And it must keep an openness, and it must keep the dialogue going in terms of how the government performs what it does. So I think you're very perceptive and very correct.
Well, the second broad approach, to which in varying degrees we all adhere, is obviously that some mistakes were made at various stages, and with the benefit of 2020 hindsight, everybody would have been able to do a better job. And I don't think this panel is the right one for me to explore what specific mistakes were made by whom. But I think it's reasonably clear to assume that even the most glorious exercise in recent history, the landing at Normandy on D-Day, had mistakes. And I don't know how far we will get by dealing with the nuanced approach to mistake hunting. And I don't want to deal with that at all, because my colleagues are doing, in varying degrees, a good job of it. The third issue that I want to get to is the analogy with Jonestown. Because at Jonestown, Judge Sessions, there was no FBI, there was no Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms. As a matter of fact, Jonestown was basically removed from the sovereign domain of the United States government. It happened elsewhere. It happened in Guyana. Yet in Jonestown, we have parallels to Waco, which are more than striking. A criminally insane, charismatic religious cult leader bringing about the death by murder or self-destruction of some 900 American citizens who, for whatever reasons, misguided religious beliefs, fear, timidity, personal relationships, what have you, have followed Jim Jones as a god, did what he wanted them to do, almost identical things, and they all perished. Is it reasonable to assume that perhaps the Koresh tragedy is most analogous to the Jim Jones Guyana tragedy? And the death and the nightmare was preordained by Koresh and his determination that these people will die with him.
There's a strong suggestion of that and a similarity. There is one factor that existed at Waco with the Branch Davidians that did not exist in Jonestown. And that is, you had law enforcement officers carrying out what they perceived to be their sworn duty in connection with the gun laws of the United States. And there were four officers killed and 20 wounded. It was that action that prompted the FBI, prompted me to call the director and say, can we be of help? And there were other connections almost immediately to the tragedy that was enacted by the original raid in connection with the ATF function. So there are similarities. And I can see that it's extremely important that the American people out of this understand that law enforcement is not allied against these people. Quite the contrary, there are many, many law-abiding sects, I'm sure, in this United States. There are many, many people who think differently and march to a different drummer. But law enforcement must protect those people and not be perceived, nor ever become, the enemy of those people, but rather protect them.
Mr. Lantos, your time has expired.
Could one more witness respond to the question?
One more may
respond.
According
to your rules, may I call on Mr. Hubble to respond to the Jonestown Waco analogy that I developed?
Congressman, I think there are a lot of analogies that can be made. I think one of the unbelievable things to me is the hold that Vernon Howe had on these people. When the Army told me that they've seen grown men run through doors as soon as were hit with this CS gas, and then to see no one come out, you realize the strong hold. I'll never forget the scene of the woman who ran back into the fire and the man who was on top of the building and who wouldn't come off the roof. That he had that kind of hold on human beings is frightening. And I do think there are analogies.
Thank you Mr. Lantos. Mr. Micah, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you. Just an observation, Mr. Sessions. We had witnesses from Britain who were testifying on the use of CS gas, and you talked about the history of the United States and the perceptions. And if you saw it, you'd see why we broke off from England, because of the cold, calculated manner in which they have no compunction about using CS gas on children and women. And that's one of the reasons, in fact, we broke off, is a difference of opinion. Mr. Hubble, do you recall a meeting on or about the 14th or 15th of April that you attended with Vince Foster, with Mr. Nussbaum, and I guess some others, in which was really a turning point, and in which the discussions were that the FBI had changed their mind, and the change in the mind was based on two things. One, a change in the situation. They planned to insert gas, some people were saying. That's one. And two, that there was concern expressed that the FBI had only one hostage rescue team and they were tiring. Do you recall that conversation in that meeting?
I recall. I believe I asked for that meeting, yes.
But was that the context of that meeting?
I'm not sure. I racked my brain, but I can't remember whether that meeting was after we met with the military, but I believe it was before.
I
believe that meeting was before, where I advised them that the FBI was proposing to insert the CS gas, and they were asking me the same kind of questions the Attorney General was asking, why now, and what had changed.
Basically, that kind of decision was made at that point, or that was the turning point. And we see all of this leading to the Attorney General's office and pointing sort of the responsibility up there, that she made a flawed decision based on flawed advice. So this is sort of the turning point where some of this took place. Did you or others at that meeting recommend, or was there any discussion about the use of military force or equipment?
There was not any discussion about use of military force. There was discussion of having the military evaluate the FBI's plan.
Dr. Salem, who asked you to brief the Attorney General specifically?
Two of my colleagues at the Edgewood Research Development and Engineering Center.
Are you aware of any second opinion? Now, it involved use of this gas where women and children, you were aware of that situation. And were you well aware of any second opinion being sought by any other expert? No?
There were other people at the meeting when
But were there other experts? You're the expert on CS gas that was retained. There wasn't a second opinion, as I understand.
I'm not aware of that, sir.
Mr. Potts, Mr. Bryan made the point earlier that your intelligence people had not told Jamar that on the morning of the 19th, the Davidians were overheard as they evidently spread fuel and allegedly started a fire. Jamar has said he would not have proceeded had he known. Whose responsibility was to get this information to Jamar?
Yes, sir. I think that's an excellent point that Mr. Bryant made this morning.
Whose responsibility was it to get the information to Jamar?
We have a we had a setup where we had monitors listening to the conversations that were going on, and they did not hear those conversations. It's not on the log, so you would expect if the monitors didn't hear the conversations, there's no way it can get then up the chain to Mr. Jamar.
So no one is taking responsibility, Mr. Richard. I guess you're one of the folks that are there now. This week, approximately half of a panel that we had testified that some of the infants and children, since they didn't have gas masks, could in fact have died from inhalation or effects of CS gas. At the very least, a Department of Justice decision in fact resulted in the babies and children being tortured for at least 3 to 4 hours before, according to autopsy reports that we have, that most of the 24 children were suffocated or burned to death. We can't go back and change what took place, but do you believe we should adopt a federal policy with respect to the use of CS gas where women and children, or particularly children and infants, are present?
I believe that you're really in the final analysis going to have to take a case-by-case assessment.
Should we have some policy?
Well, we should certainly go with very hesitantly and very thoughtfully in all such instances in using the gas. But I would not simply, based on my understanding of the effects of the gas and its lethality, I wouldn't want to suggest that we just ban its conceivable use on policy grounds without taking a case-by-case assessment.
Mr. Chairman, do I still have time?
Nope, you've run out of time, Mr. Micah. And I recognize for 5 minutes Ms. Jackson Lee.
Mr. Chairman, I thank you very much, and gentlemen, good morning to you, and I thank you for your presence here. Please bear with me as I just offer to you two amendments in the Bill of Rights. A Second Amendment talks about a well-regulated militia being necessary to the security of a free state. The right of the people to keep and bear arms shall not be infringed. Judge Sessions, you have mentioned the politicizing of the ATF, but might I get you to comment on whether or not the rights of David Koresh might have been violated under the Second Amendment as we read this language? Are Americans still protected under the Second Amendment in light of the need that was perceived to go in and investigate Mr. Koresh?
On the use of the word politicizing, I did not say that the ATF was politicized. I said that they are involved in an issue that is guns, which is very political in nature by virtue of the Second Amendment discussion.
And will you then get to my question on the Second Amendment and Mr. Koresh?
With Mr. Koresh, the ATF, it's my understanding, believed that he was in violation of the gun laws of the United States, and that because he was in violation, he was answerable to a warrant for both arrest and for search.
So,
and therefore, they did that.
Lawfully keeping guns for hunting or sport are in keeping with the Second Amendment. Is that my understanding of what you're saying?
Well, it's clear that there is no question that where you keep weapons that are in violation of the law and are listed as being weapons that are prohibited, that you are in violation of the law and subject to warrant, either for arrest or for search.
And so it would be, based upon the facts that have come to you, it would be your assessment that most Americans are protected under the Second Amendment in the lawful manner of keeping weapons.
I think all Americans are protected by the Second Amendment. I think that the matter of keeping weapons, as long as they are not in violation of the law, is well described and well established.
Frankly, then, let me say what I think many Americans are thinking as these hearings are unfolding. What they are perceiving, or what their apprehension is the fear of militaristic domination and law enforcement domination. And so I've got to pursue again this whole question of the Fourth Amendment. I asked you about the Second Amendment because if we hold to a high standard, the Second Amendment, the rights of people to bear arms, then it seems unlikely that a government should then attempt to remove from citizens the same right of unreasonable search and seizures, which might be thought to be the case under the weakening of the exclusionary rule. And you being a former federal court judge, and certainly your leadership of the FBI, I again ask you, do we do ourselves well in this nation and answer the question of the fear of militaristic domination and law enforcement domination by the weakening of the exclusionary rule?
Well, I have answered Mr. Scott's original question and Mr. Watt's original question, and now yours very, very clearly. I have no question in my mind that the Fourth Amendment means exactly what it says and it should be maintained, and that we should, on the other side of it, insist that and provide for the enhancement of the professionalism of law, all law enforcement, so they know the standards and they follow the standards and they are trained and it's second nature to them, so that you do not have any infringement or impairment of the Fourth Amendment right.
So you think that it is certainly positive to have an independent intervener, cooled heads, cooled minds, to review whatever the representations are being made by a law enforcement officer for a viable, verifiable search warrant?
Well, that's intended, that a warrant be issued by the authority having been properly informed. So the answer is yes.
And proper information is certainly a key element.
Proper information is critical, and it always has been critical and always will continue to be. That's the integrity of the warrant. If it's on improper information or deceptive information, then you weaken the warrant, and you should not do that.
I noticed that some who are on the panel this morning visited the site and others did not. And Judge Sessions, I too hold you in high respect, but let me query you on this issue, for I think, again, apprehension is our government in control of itself. Would you respond to the allegations that the reason why we had a Waco is because the FBI was in disarray?
The reason why we had a Waco was
the ultimate results of the 51-day siege and the ultimate going in is because the FBI itself, the organizational structure, was in disarray.
Well,
how would
obvious.
You respond to that allegation?
Well, I would respond to it this way. It is obvious that from the time of the change in the administration, it was very clear that there was great discussion about the replacement of the director of the FBI. That discussion was well known by Mr. Hubble, well known by the Attorney General, well known by everybody. The decisions had been made probably earlier. But I do not believe that the discipline nor the ability of the FBI was impacted at all. Now, there may be others that disagree. I know this is a very political thing, and I agree that with your observation that it could be that the FBI was impaired in its ability. Certainly, I was impaired in my ability to be able to negotiate, to be able to actually go down, as we discussed with Attorney General Gerson. The idea of the director ever becoming directly involved in negotiation because those were hometown folk was dismissed as ridiculous and grandstanding. It was also discussed that it was not appropriate for an FBI director to respond to a hostage type or this type of circumstance. So there are elements of it. And I continue, and continue to this day, my strong belief you must negotiate, you must be patient, and yet you must apply the appropriate pressure. And I think we did those three things, which indicate that the government was not in disarray, nor the Bureau.
Mr. Jackson, your time has expired. Judge Sessions is going to have to leave us
Thank
when we go for
Mr.
these
Chairman.
Votes. We're going to have a series of three. Because he is going to leave, I'm going to recognize Mr. Blute, who has a question for you, for whatever time he consumes, and he'll retain then the balance of that time because we're going to have to go vote before he could use up 5 minutes. So, Mr. Blute.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to thank the panel for their testimony. Judge Sessions, I want to get back to something that you touched on briefly earlier, but I think is a very important point, and that's Mr. Smerick's testimony that he felt pressure from FBI higher-ups to change his recommendations from a passive approach to a more confrontational approach. I think this is a crucial issue to understand how the pressure built to move towards a confrontational approach. He mentioned you specifically a number of times in relationship to this, and I wondered if you could again explain how you relayed to Mr. Smerick.
I cannot ever recall having a conversation with Mr. Smerick, nor being indicating to him my displeasure about his approach. I suggest what you do is you go down the line. That you ask Mr. Clark if he had that. You ask Mr. Potts if he had that. I don't know where it came from, but I was not displeased with the idea of negotiating ever, nor the attempts to negotiate. In fact, as I said, it subjected me to some ridicule there early on because I felt that the discussions down there in Waco early on might have yielded fruit. I talked with Steve Higgins about it. We talked directly about the possibility of going down together and having a circumstance where we could have some negotiation. There were many people willing, including Mr. DeGuerin, Mr. Coker, to be able to deal with that negotiation phase. So no, it just is not a correct concept. I don't know where he got it, but he didn't get it from me.
So you didn't send any signals that you were concerned about his recommendations of
Mr.
Blute,
Mr. Blute, I'm a direct man. And I know the King's English, and I know how to speak about what I believe. And if there is anybody here who says I indicated that I had that belief, then they need to stand up and say so. It just didn't happen.
Thank you, Judge, and I'll reserve the balance of my time.
Thank you. At this point, you've used 1.5 minutes. We are going to be in recess until 5 minutes after the last of a series of 3 votes. Judge Sessions, and we know you won't be back. We want to thank you for coming. The rest of the panel, we know we will convene. I do not expect us to break for lunch for this panel, so we will be back and go through the lunch period. Thank you.
Thank you.
You're watching the 8th of 10 days of last month's hearings on the incident in Waco, Texas in 1993. Our coverage will continue in a few moments. First, you'll hear from several reporters who covered the Waco hearings. We asked them about the most interesting moments and witnesses.
Well, I thought there were a number of key witnesses. First day, Curie Jewell, she was the 14-year-old girl who told of being sexually abused by Koresh when she was 10 in a hotel room in Texas. She told of beatings that took place and people being beaten by Koresh kids with boat oars. She really set the tone for the hearings. And you couldn't walk away without just being really struck by this 14-year-old girl with her father there kind of stroking her in the back and supporting her and her doing what she could to tell as best she could that story. But again, I mean, what we saw there was the Democrats were just, they were giddy at her testimony. The idea that she had basically made Koresh out to be this beast, and they used her day in and day out afterwards to say, well, you know, the attention is misplaced. It shouldn't be on law enforcement. It should be on David Koresh and what a beast he is and what a pervert. And then the Republicans would continually come back and say that they were embarrassed that she had to tell that testimony. And she was constantly the subject throughout of this partisan wrangling. But you walk away with it. It was really a brilliant stroke on the Democrats' part to get her on the first day and to tell that story. And all of a sudden, kind of the mistakes and the errors made by law enforcement, which there were a number of them made here, and serious ones, were kind of put in perspective. I think that hurt the Republicans very badly.
Was there a moment in the hearings that was particularly riveting for you as a journalist?
Well, for several for us in Texas. One was the testimony of former Treasury Secretary Lloyd Benson, former senator from our state, who was heavily criticized by members of the panel for what they felt was a lack of activity on his part, for not getting as involved as he should have in the raid. Secretary Benson, of course, said that he was delegating responsibility to the ATF and to others. So that was a particularly interesting part of the hearings for us. And also Janet Reno's testimony on the final day, which kind of wrapped up everything that had happened in the 9 days previous. It was a final opportunity for people to really say what was on their mind about the Waco incident. And the exchanges between Ms. Reno and members of the committee, particularly the Republican members, parts of it were quite interesting.
I think the highlights, it was quite exciting when Curie Jewell, the 14-year-old girl, testified that she had been molested by David Koresh, and when the undercover agent testified, Mr. Rodriguez, about the scene on the day of the February 28th raid. We had not heard a first-person account of that before, and he had been in the room when David Koresh learned of the impending raid, and that was quite exciting, but the rest of it was an awful lot of partisan bickering, hours and hours of it at a time.
Tomorrow, day 9 of the Waco hearings. The witnesses include a panel of FBI special agents. And on Friday, we'll air the final day of the House hearings with testimony from Attorney General Janet Reno. We now return to coverage of day 8 of the House Waco hearings. Today's hearings run until about 6 p.m. Eastern Time. During this panel, we'll hear more testimony from FBI official Larry Potts, Defense Department toxicologist Harry Salem, and Mark Richard of the Justice Department.
The Waco matter will reconvene. We just had a break for votes. There were three votes on the floor of the House, and members have come back. When we took our break, Mr. Blute had consumed 1.5 minutes of 5 minutes of time, which he had in order to ask Judge Sessions a question before Mr. Sessions had to leave, which he knew and we knew in advance he would have to do at around 11 o'clock. Now I will recognize Mr. Blute for the remaining 3.5 minutes of the time that he has. Mr. Blute.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to ask the FBI representatives about some of the questioning of, that I asked Judge Sessions about Mr. Smerick's recommendations and whether there was pressure generated from above to change his recommendation to conform with some type of preordained outcome, which I think is very troubling and indicates where the pressure built for the final confrontation, perhaps not in Waco, Texas, but perhaps in Washington, D.C. Now, Judge Sessions said that he knew nothing about that. I tend to believe him. But I also believe Mr. Smerick is sincere in testifying that, although he thought it was Judge Sessions, that there were some pressure on him, that there was some pressure on him to change his recommendation. I wonder if Mr. Clark would comment on that. Did you know of any, or did you engage in any pressure, sending signals down the line that this recommendation was not the proper recommendation?
I'm unaware of any pressure, and I did not see or hear or read of all of Mr. Smerick's testimony, but one piece that I did catch indicated to me that he believed that the pressure was more self-imposed as opposed to somebody overtly imposing upon
him. But he did say that he, when asked where that pressure was coming from, he didn't refer to it as pressure, but I think we can assume it was a form of pressure. He mentioned Judge Sessions in particular.
I'm not aware of any discussions that Mr. Sessions ever had with Pete Smerick. I know I never had any. I am at a loss to explain that.
Mr. Potts?
Yes, sir. When I first became aware that there was concern over one of Pete Smerick's memos, and I think it was, I'm not sure the exact date, I think it was around the 5th or somewhere around there, March 5th. Jeff Jamar expressed to me some concern that that he believed that Pete thought that we were trying to go forward with something tactically at that time, and that because of the tone of the memo, that it would leave them with no flexibility at all down there. And I said, well, look, that's one opinion, and I think what you do is what we have to do is listen to that, evaluate that opinion, and you also have to get other opinions and see how they feel about that. Someone in Washington at the command center contacted John Douglas just to say, John Douglas was Pete Smerick's supervisor, to say, we want you to sit down and evaluate this also, and we also want you to sit down with Pete and go through his assessment and see if you concur with his assessment. We actually, I believe, Pete's assessment early on, especially with regard to the pull everything back and get away from him, don't show the vehicles the way they are, but I think that memo also said only do that if they will bring the children out, if they'll agree to bring some of the children out, and if at the same time Koresh will agree to come out, not at that time, but that he'll say that he'll eventually surrender. And it was probably a day or so thereafter that Jeff Jamar made that offer to Koresh that said, we'll pull everything back. We'll pull all the Bradleys back. We'll pull everything back and away if you'll just send, and he didn't even limit it to children, if you'll send 4 people out, we'll pull everything back. And that was disregarded.
Let me just quickly ask Mr. Hubble, you said the military was to review the plan. Did the military pass judgment on the plan? What was their opinion of the final plan?
We wanted them to critique the plan and give us any opinion they had that thought of how it could be improved. Now, I didn't sit in in the meetings that maybe the FBI had with the military before they both jointly briefed the Attorney General and myself and others. And so there may have been other suggestions they made prior to that. I just don't know. I know what we discussed, but they critiqued the plan and they said they believed it would work.
Mr. Blute, your time has expired. Ms. Lofgren, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. You know, one of the interesting aspects of this hearing is that it's gone on long enough that our constituents back home realize that there are hearings and they're calling in with questions and advice. It's amazing to me how many people in America have been tear gassed. I guess every soldier who went through basic training was tear gassed. I've heard from a lot of them. Now grown-ups who were undergraduates who had their dorms tear gassed in the late 60s and 70s, and even people who were celebrating the 4th of July on the Capitol Mall in 1971 in the Nixon administration, when I guess there were some anti-war demonstrators and tear gas was applied on not only the demonstrators but all the families with kids who were picnicking on the 4th of July. One of the inputs I've had is from someone I never served in the military, but someone who did, who suggested that if this had been a military endeavor rather than a law enforcement endeavor, that probably what would have occurred would be not a gradual insertion of gas, but massive gassing that would then have brought the people out. I don't know if that's true or not, but I'm wondering, Dr. Salem, had that happened, would the risk to the people inside have been greater? Were there constraints in terms of their safety that would have prevented the FBI from taking a more military assault gas approach than was taken in this case?
According to the evidence, after you reach the irritating point, if you increase the concentration, it does not really increase the symptoms. You get your profuse symptoms that occur. And the use of tear gas, any type of tear gas in CS, it entails some degree of risk. But in my opinion, CS does not cause permanent injury to adults or to children. And this is based on the best available information. And based on that, CS is the best riot control agent. Now, the Attorney General was extremely sensitive to the risks and obviously had to balance them. And the final analysis, the question of the use of CS comes down to balancing the risks against the consequences, even the consequences of waiting. And that was a very tough decision that they had to make.
Mr. Potts, was there a consideration of not gradual insertion, but a more voluminous insertion of gas? And why was that? Was it really just hesitation, or why was the decision made?
There absolutely was a recommendation. The hostage rescue team and most of the SACs felt very strongly that it would be better to have a full insertion, as well as, you know, the military said if they were doing a military operation, that's the way they'd do it. Our concern about doing that is that we thought that we significantly reduced the risk to the children. We also significantly reduced the chance of them having a violent reaction if we did it in a measured way. We increased the risk to our agents, but we decreased the risk of a violent response, we believe, as well as to the children.
Let me ask you this. I had some constituents who are in here in the Capitol today, really on a vacation, and they they asked me, you know, why are we doing this? I mean, didn't this happen 2.5 years ago? And finally said, well, I guess the only real value on this, in their view, I'm quoting them, was if we could learn something for the future that would make our country better prepared to deal with such an issue. And that has been very much a concern of mine. Now, I've read through the Treasury report as well as the Justice Department reports, not just what happened, but how could we do a better job in the future. And I'm particularly interested in how we are organized to understand groups of people that might be operating on a worldview that is different than average. Now, I was frankly very impressed by what I heard the other day about the number of experts and the like. But the question is to Mr. Potts, Are you satisfied that we have done all we could? What if the next group, and that may happen as the millennium approaches, is a group that is, say, animism, that the average officer really doesn't know much about? Do we have experts set up, and do we have training for our law enforcement people to really understand the information they're getting and incorporate it so that they can make prudent decisions? Are you satisfied with the recommendations that have been made so far?
I'm satisfied with the recommendations, and I think we've made good progress on those. I think we'll have better coordination. I think we have people who are better trained. And I think that the component of our crisis intervention response group now that puts our negotiators and our hostage rescue team together within one unit, I think that one component of that element is set up to really reach out to places like the University of Michigan and others that have behavioral science understandings and to develop a real core of people that we can call on in these kind of crises who could give us the best advice possible. I think we've made great strides in that regard.
And if you could just real quickly answer my question, have we trained the people within the FBI to really understand the information that is being given to them by the experts?
Well, I think we're in the process of doing that. I think that that's underway.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Heineman, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And I have to say, for the past 8 days, I've felt some degree of discomfort sitting here and on the opposite side of the law enforcement officials as it relates to that table, and that table only, and certainly you folks being in a high-ranking administrative position. But that discomfort is rather easy for me to take, because I know that what we're doing here is not really second-guessing, but critiquing what happened on two issues that really need to be critiqued so that we can understand what happened. We can place responsibility, and I don't want to say blame, because I think the people at the operating levels really thought that they were doing the right thing. And certainly I wasn't there. But as I see this information having filtered up the line of responsibility, it gets fuzzy. It gets hazy as to the Attorney General, who did initially feel a great deal of discomfort with what happened, and I believe Mr. Langan and the Treasury Department or someone of his equal rank felt discomfort too with that February 28th raid. But those feelings of discomfort really didn't last long. And I would just like, if I can, and I don't have enough time, 5 minutes, to find out really what changed people's minds, what changed the Attorney General's mind from a feeling of discomfort, and what changed Mr. Langan, if it was him, his mind. I know Mr. Higgins did prevail upon him to accept the plan, and of course, we know what happened after that. But I think, being a member of Congress, I have as we all do, a strong obligation to let the people in this country know that they're getting a fair deal, that there is no cover-up, that there was no cover-up, or if that's a perception that's out there, then I think we need to throw cold water on that fire. Because as it grows, we can see militias grow because of a strong feeling against government law enforcement. And I'm not going to say that there's a direct relationship, but I believe that there's an indirect relationship to what happened in Oklahoma City by a mindset that's in this country that feels government is against them and needs to be retaliated against. So what we're doing is extremely important. And Congress itself is on trial here, and I've said that before. So I don't make any apologies for us asking hard questions. And certainly I'm not looking to throw cold water on witnesses as we have here, discrediting witnesses, even law enforcement, because we didn't agree with them. But having said that, Mr. Potts, on April the 14th, Mr. Jamar related to you the conversation he had with the lawyers, Mr. Livingston and Mr. Livingston, is that the right?
Mr. DeGuerin.
DeGuerin and Zimmerman. I'm sorry.
Yes.
And he told you that information that he thought that they thought they had a deal with Koresh to come out with that letter that he.
I think that the whole plan to come out was earlier in April. The whole plan, just and that plan was the same as it was early in March, except it inserted the attorneys into it. The issue of the manuscript that now that he's decided that Passover's over.
Can I reclaim my time?
I'm sorry.
I know about that. I may have had my dates wrong. But the attorneys stated that Mr. Jamar had told them, you have all the time you need. And I have a little problem with that being changed, if it was changed. Apparently, the lawyers felt devastated, but when they found out that on the 19th there was an assault on a compound, did anybody have a feel that perhaps the chemistry has changed, and this might be an open end to pursue a reason not to go in? And I can certainly understand law enforcement's right. wanting to go in. I was part of that, and I'm sympathetic with their feelings on that.
Sir, I never got the impression from talking to anyone on site at Waco, from my position in Washington, that anyone believed that there had been any substantial change in David Koresh. In fact, it was clearly stated to me that they thought this was a continuing manipulation, a continuing delaying tactic, that he had no intention of coming out, and they continued to monitor that from the 14th up through the morning of the 19th, and saw nothing to convince them any differently in between.
Okay, could it not have been handled differently as it related to relieving your HRT teams, and they certainly should have been relieved, and replacing them with perhaps DPS, Department of Public Safety, or another agency, unless you can tell us here that there was some imperative for the FBI being able to handle that alone?
Well, I believe that the hostage rescue team, by its nature and by its training, is the finest law enforcement team of its type in the nation. So I do believe that they are different from the other teams. They are a team that trains every day. They're a team that's full-time tactical, as opposed to our SWAT teams or most other SWAT teams around the country. But more importantly than that, to me, in terms of waiting, we had a lot of behavioralists at that time who were looking at letters that Koresh was sending out and who had been evaluating him throughout, some of them, throughout the course of this standoff, who said that they don't believe that Koresh is going to commit suicide. They don't believe that there's necessarily going to be a mass suicide, but they think that if there is a suicide effort, that it would be suicide, as they call it, suicide by cop, and that there might be some kind of a breakout plan, and that Koresh has his own time frame. The government has their time frame that they're working on under, and David has his own separate one. And so he might decide at any time to come out. Obviously.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Heineman. Ms. Collins, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. During these hearings, we've listened to exhaustive academic discussion about CS tear gas, and these issues will continue to be debated as they should. But for the American public, the basic question is how carefully the FBI and the Department of Justice considered the effect of CS tear gas on children, pregnant women, and the elderly before it was inserted into the Davinian compound. And the testimony we have heard has made it clear that the decision to use tear gas had to be balanced with the risk to these individuals against the risk of allowing the standoff to continue. So, Mr. Clark, I'm going to ask you, what was your involvement in the decision to use the tear gas in the compound, A, what meetings you personally participated in, B, and who you consulted with about the possible effects on the children, C?
That's a very long question, and I have to tell you, before I get started, I would have a long answer to it because there's a number of factors, and I know that you're trying to condensed time. The issue of tear gas came up fairly early on because if there were a problem inside that we had to respond to, how would we respond? And so the issue of tear gas came up fairly early on. And the experts in the Criminal Investigative Division and on the hostage rescue team almost at the outset began to do research and on a number of different other alternatives. Somewhere in late March, the other options had been tried and failed, and the recommendations were coming in from Waco that
They wanted to develop a plan to use gas, and a plan was submitted. It was deemed by most of us at headquarters that it was not the time yet to do that. There were other things that we were still exploring. Those discussions were ongoing when Mr. Potts and I accompanied Mr. Richards to Waco, and that was on the 7th and 8th of April. I still, at that point, did not believe that the use of gas was appropriate at that time. After the discussions that we had down there, we had the opportunity to talk to our negotiators, the HRT people, the SACs, all of the people, all of the components that were involved, that on the night of April the 8th, after consulting with the four SACs, the hostage rescue team leader, Mr. Potts, and myself, I became convinced that there was an option that could bring about a safe resolution to this problem. We came back and briefed the director. That was done on the 9th. Concluding that briefing, the director also agreed and contacted the Attorney General. So I would say that my decision in supporting it occurred on the evening of the 8th, and I discussed that on the 9th with the director.
Did you specifically consult with anyone about the possible effects on children of the CST?
Extensively.
Yes. Extensively.
Extensively.
With the people that you've already talked about?
And Tony Betts, who I understand has already been a witness here. I had, at that time, had not had direct conversation with Dr. Salem, but I was aware that the people that were actually doing the research here had talked to a number of experts. We had had an ongoing for some time under Director Webster. The Bureau had started a program looking at less than lethal weapons. We had held symposia at Quantico looking for different ways. There was extensive research that had been done and a number of people within the Bureau and outside of the Bureau that were consulted.
I don't want to cut you off, but I want to hear what Dr. Salem has to say about the use of CS, tear gas on children, and whatever he thought about this.
When I was contacted, we reviewed all of the available literature on the effects, the toxicology, and the safety of CS, in particular its effect on children and pregnant women. And based on all the available literature, there was a lot of experiments done on adults and older people. No experiments were done on children. However, there were several cases reported in the literature. The one case of that young infant, that four-month-old infant, who survived after 28 days of hospitalization following a massive dose that it was exposed to. The other is the actual occurrence in Northern Ireland when CS was used in those at that time. And the reports showed that they investigated. There were children that were exposed. None of the children required hospitalization. They don't know what the dose was, but it was much less than the other one. Those are the only published literature on the effects of CS on children. And based on that, as a scientist, we look at what the facts are rather than anecdotal. And even though these were anecdotal, they were followed up by epidemiological studies. There were animal studies using young animals, and they did not find a difference. And it was concluded by many researchers, very competent researchers, that there was no difference in sensitivity to the CS by young people, older people, and the infirm. And tear gas is really a generic term. CS has been available, it is not a military unique chemical. It's been available to law enforcement officers and even to the public. As you know, you can buy CS in combination with other deterrents in the grocery stores.
Well, let me ask you something before you go any further. If you had been in a position of making a decision whether or not to put CS gas into the Davidian compound, knowing that there were children there, would you have done that?
I was not asked to make that decision.
No, I said if. It's a hypothetical.
Based on
your scientific knowledge of
if,
the...
If chemicals had to be used, that would be the chemical of choice.
Why?
Pardon?
Why?
Because it is the most extensively studied agent of that type, and it is the safest. There are no authenticated deaths following its use.
Thank you, Mrs. Collins. Mr. Souter, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
I just want to make sure that the record shows that, in fact, Mr. Betts said that he was only a tactical expert yesterday, and he referred to Dr. Salem, that the extent of the research consists of, in Ireland, we don't know the dose, we don't know whether they were necessarily confined, but they were, and one child who recovered, and that based on this extensive research, a decision was made that Dr. Salem himself just said that if you had to use a chemical, apparently because at least there was no evidence of deaths, he would have used this chemical. Hardly a compelling argument, but not one that proves any deaths occurred or anything bad happened, but not exactly a compelling argument. I earlier heard Director or Judge Sessions say that the Attorney General was kept briefed in detail because of her concerns about the children, and yet we heard yesterday when I asked Mr. Jamar, he said 99% likelihood that there would be fired upon, which seemed pretty logical, actually, but that didn't get up the system. And I wanted to ask Mr. Hubble whether he and Attorney General, did you know that the FBI didn't know where the children would be located in the compound when they gassed it?
They did not. We were advised, we asked where the children would be located, the likely place that they would be located. We're told by the FBI where the likely place they would be located based on interviews with people who had left the compound. So we did ask those questions, and we're given those answers.
Okay, because Mr. Jamar said yesterday when I asked him that he didn't know, and in fact when they had hoped that they would be in the bus, but they weren't there. And so I just wanted to make sure that they did express to you that they didn't exactly know, but they made their best guess.
They did not precisely know. I think they had hoped that if the children didn't come out, that they would be put in the bus. I don't think I was told that that's where they would sleep that night. I think they were supposed to more than likely be sleeping with their parents in the compound.
One other question, then I'm going to yield to Mr. Bryant. In a similar vein, when I asked Mr. Jamar about where they were pouring the fuel, and he said that they couldn't hear back that they were pouring the fuel. Did the Attorney General and you understand that there wouldn't be a way to hear what was going on in the compound to be able to adjust? Because he said if he had known that, he would have adjusted. Did you understand that there was an equipment problem, that there wasn't going to be that exchange?
We were aware that there were surveillance devices in the compound. We weren't totally, my understanding was, and then on the day, some of them were not working, that there was some suspicion that the people within the compound knew there were surveillance devices and were using that as part of the manipulation, and that they could, you know, terminate their usefulness or destroy them at will. So we knew that we had surveillance devices within the compound, but we weren't confident that they would be available during the insertion of gas the day before, and then certainly we were aware of some of the problems that occurred while the scene unfolded on the 19th.
Thank you very much. I yield the rest of my time to Mr. Bryant.
Thank you. Let me ask, I've got time for just about one question here. Mr. Hubble, putting things in context at the White House at this point, you were appointed by the President, again, you're some say the best friend, to head the transition team, the administration into the Department of Justice. And they had people in the other departments also. But you were the one to head the transition team into Justice. And we've just been through, in the context of that time frame, the failures of, I guess, Ms. Baird, Ms. Woods, I don't know if Ms. Guineer had come along at that point, but certainly there were some failures with the White House and the Department of Justice. And then you've got the Waco standoff, the siege, certainly applying some pressure there. And I'm still having some difficulty in accepting the statement that you were not dealing directly with the White House. And maybe I didn't make my questions clear about the President, but certainly you had lots of other friends over there, Mr. Lindsay, Mr. Foster, Mr. McClarty, all from Arkansas. And at heading the transition team, you had Mr. Gerson, who was the acting Attorney General, but he was a Bush holdover. So I can imagine your contact, especially with the President, indicating that he wanted to be made aware of any change, any shift in strategy
I find it difficult, and I found a couple of phone calls where the president called you during that time frame on the list here. The article that I quoted you from the paper said that, and again, you deny that making this statement, that you had talked business with Clinton only when the president sought updates in the early days of the cult crisis in Waco, and that's certainly consistent with telephone calls from the president to you during March, which is documented on the log. Mm-hmm. Again, weren't you, in fact, communicating with the president because he wanted to know what was going on and if there was a change in strategy? Ultimately, he could have approved that, or ultimately, he could have even disapproved that. I understand that he relied a lot on his new Attorney General, Ms. Reno, at that time, but in the end, he did have that ultimate authority as the president, as Ms. Reno's boss, as your boss, to say, no, let's don't do that. Now, I understand he relied on her, but I, under the context of the situation, weren't you, in fact, dealing with the president some and other members, other friends over there, and keeping them apprised as what was going on at Waco?
I did. I think I did testify, Congressman. If I didn't, I want to make clear. The beginning, when the FBI advised me of their plan and the possibility of the insertion of gas, I did notify the White House counsel and kept in contact through the White House counsel. I'm sure the White House counsel advised the president, but that's the way I kept the White House advised of the plan and what we were doing, the evaluation that was going on. So I don't mean to say I never talked to the White House. I did not talk to the President of the United States about this issue prior to the 19th.
Time has expired. Ms. Slaughter, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm sure you gentlemen are familiar enough with the way the government and Congress operates to know that you were damned if you did and damned if you didn't. And if you followed some of the advice you're getting here now and built a fence or stayed there for 2 years, everybody would be yelling every day, look how much it costs. These are supposed to be the best in the world. What in the world's going on down here? One of the things that I have learned is that before Waco, the department, ATF, and I guess Mr. Potts can verify this, really didn't have very much connection to the top echelon of the Treasury Department. And that before Secretary Benson made some changes, that it was not really a normal thing for the Secretary of the Treasury to know at all times what BATF is doing. Is that correct, Mr. Potts?
I'm afraid I'm not your good expert on that. I'm not sure how ATF operated within Treasury in terms of who
you came in with
to.
The Clinton administration, or weren't you already there?
I came in 21 years ago, over 21 years ago, as a civil servant FBI agent.
I see.
Just an FBI agent.
Well, that had been testified to here before, and I think probably the one thing that I've learned is that there have been massive changes at Treasury to make sure that the kinds of breaches that happen won't happen again. For example, I'm absolutely persuaded from what I've heard that the reason four agents died and the Branch Davidians on February 28th is because there was no security. And that a postman who heard it from a television man, who learned it from a woman who had rented ambulances to the ATF, talked. And that steps have been taken to make sure that that doesn't happen again. But one of the things that was the saddest to me here, and I don't know if you've heard the testimony, I hope you've been busy since we all work for the same company here, was from Ms. Sparks, which seemed to me that when she walked into that into the compound, knowing that her visit had been compromised, that she was only allowed to see certain children in certain areas, and yet she said by her testimony that there was one running sink with running water, there was no sanitation facilities, the children were obviously shell-shocked to some degree, the conditions were so bad there that I've often wondered why the state of Texas did not remove the children from that compound at that time. Has that occurred to any of you, that under child protective laws they would have done that normally? And what a change that might have made? It hasn't, I see that. All right. One of the things that I wanted to point out as well is that because of the deteriorating conditions, and as a former bacteriologist, I understand this very well. And I think that everybody on the scene has explained the deteriorating sanitary conditions taking place in that compound. There was no electricity, correct? There was no way to heat food, no way to heat anything up to kill bacteria. There was no way to dispose of sewage. Isn't that not correct?
That's correct.
And I think that although you seem to have heard from every behavioral psychologist in America and all kinds of negotiators, I don't hear of anybody talking to any medical personnel. I assume they would have said to you, those children have got to come out of there, or they're going to be seriously ill. from the conditions under which they live. Is it not true, however, that not a single soul could leave that compound without Koresh's permission? There seems to be an implication here from time to time. If you'd waited, people would have come out.
I think the general way that he told us from the beginning, anybody who wants to come out can come out. However, the problem with that is we found that the process was that in order to come out, you have to first have, I think as one of the negotiators described it the other day, an exit interview with David. And it's that point which we believe they talked about their salvation and their soul. And so a lot who maybe wanted to come out had their mind changed as a result of those talks.
The people who did come out, there were some 34, I believe, that were saved that did leave the compound.
35 total before the fire.
He started out first with children, correct?
That's true. In the first few days, a lot of children came
out. Not his own biological children, though, of which I think there were some 15. Is that correct?
I don't know the number of his biological children, except that on March 5th, or rather, I think March 5th was the last day that any child came out. March 7th, or in that area, he told our negotiators when we were talking to him about more children, sending more children out, he said, you're talking about my biological children now, and pretty much indicated that there wouldn't be any more children coming out.
Did you have any reason to believe that there was a special category of persons coming out, perhaps somebody he was uncertain of, somebody who caused him trouble? Did he get rid of any people that he thought might want to cause an uprising among his other followers or something as things got more and more tense and conditions got worse?
I think our negotiators believed, and they believed on site, that those that you have just described very thoroughly, those who came out.
As far as I'm concerned, I think these hearings have showed what I'd said before, that I think changes have been made. Other than that, it's taken an awful lot of man and woman hours of federal employees for us to go over this one more time. I can appreciate what it's been like for you. I'm sitting here watching people, grown men, burst into tears, and the pain that people have had of reliving this. Hindsight is so easy for us to talk about, but I think that the law enforcement, the people who were there facing death on a daily basis and who walked up to those doors, really deserve not our approbation, but the fact that we are grateful that they'll do that when the government asks them to.
Thank you, Ms. Slaughter. Mr. Shatter, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Potts, I'd like to begin with you. First of all, I have no sympathy for the Davidians who participated in the murder of the agents. Clearly, you were dealing with some cold-blooded people. Problem is, we have women in there, and we had children in there as well. Your goal and the FBI's goal was to avoid further loss of life, was it not?
Yes, sir, it was.
Okay. And this was, while not a classic hostage situation, you had to presume the children were innocent, and perhaps some of the women inside were innocent. Did you not?
Well, we certainly believe that there were people in there who we considered a barricaded situation, but they were kind of a hostage of the circumstance, I think.
And the children were certainly not guilty of any criminal conduct.
That's right.
Okay. The goal of the gas insertion plan was, as I understand it, to force the Davidians out, hopefully without harm to them and without harm particularly to the children, correct?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Indeed, not injuring the children was an extremely important goal for the Attorney General, it appears, from her discussions,
yes, sir,
and for the President. Is that what you understood?
I certainly understood that no one wanted any harm to come to anyone
you,
in there.
You would agree with that, would you not, Mr. Hubble?
Yes, I would.
As a matter of fact, we've had extensive testimony about the selection of CS gas as non-lethal or non-toxic, and we have great debates about whether it was or wasn't, but the whole idea here was not to hurt people, right?
That is correct.
Okay, I want to go into a series of pictures that I wish I had a video, because if I had a video, which I've watched, but I can't show here, it shows this sequence rather dramatically. You see these pictures over here, you'll see at the back of the building right there where the gentleman is pointing is a room that's differently called. Sometimes the FBI calls it a shooting range, sometimes it's called a gymnasium, sometimes it's called an auditorium. And I believe it is some 65, Sean, how long is it? 65 feet long, and how deep? Okay, I want to focus on that building right there and on that corner. You see it's now structurally sound. This is while the compound's going on. Would you go to the next photo? In the next photo, and unfortunately we don't have these very well, but we're now looking kind of from the front corner. These are taken from the airplanes. You will see that where he is pointing, that section of the building is gone. Indeed, a great portion of the building is gone. The diagram which shows the insertion shows when you watch the videotape, shows that this tank, can you show the tank? Is it tank is visible in that picture? That tank right there goes into that portion of the building, and unfortunately we don't have these photos in a very good sequence. I got to deal with what I'm given. But it goes into the building so far that the back of the tank disappears. You can't see it. Indeed, it goes so far into the building it appears it goes all the way to the opposite wall. And it goes in and out and in and out and in and out and in and out. I couldn't count the number of times. But you will see in this particular picture, Sean, you can show that the left slope, the right slope of the roof is still there. Is the left slope of the roof still there in that photograph? Both slopes of the roof are there. Now you go to the next picture, if you would, Sean. The next picture shows that the tank goes in and back out. And that portion of the building then is gone. Here's the tank going in. Go to the next picture, if you would, Sean. Here it shows, can you see the roof line? Show the roof line of that part of the gym, Sean. Right there is the peak line. You'll see now both the left and the right sides of the back of that gym are gone. Indeed, the entire roof of that one half of the gym is crushed. So we're talking a space 50 feet by 50 feet is crushed. And the entire part has fallen. And the video shows the tank going in and out and in and out. If you go to the next photo. Now we have that from the back, and we see the tank from a different angle. This is the tank that's gone in and out repeatedly over and over and over again. And now we can see from that side that that part of the building is completely crushed. I guess I find that somewhat inconsistent, and I'm trying to find out. I understand the theory of puncturing escape holes somewhere in the building. Indeed, on the front, there are two or three escape holes that were punched. If you'll show, Sean, on the left side of the back of that building, there is an escape hole further to the left right there. This is an escape hole. I'm having some difficulty with that entire section of roof, some 50 feet by 50 feet or 45 feet by 45 feet, being crushed by a tank going in and out. And while you can't see it in a still photo, there is a picture of the tank literally going up on top of the roof. Once the roof collapsed and hit the ground, and in the video you can see that very clearly, and it hits the ground. In a later sequence, the tank, one point it falls on the tank comes out, it falls the rest of the way, the tank goes up on the roof and crushes the right side of it, and then comes back out, and goes back in, and crushes the left side of it, to where, as you can see in this final photograph, that entire section of the building is gone. I'm having great difficulty with understanding if the insertion of the gas is to be non-lethal, why we are crushing an entire section of the building. And if the Attorney General was told, and I'm running out of time, so let me just posit these questions. If the Attorney General was told that a part of the strategy this early was going to be to crush significant sections of the structure, was the Attorney General warned that while we'd been very cautious about selecting what your experts say or experts say was non-lethal gas, we might still crush sections of the building? Did she understand that people might be killed if sections of the building were crushed? Was she or the President advised that if sections of the building were crushed, that might itself cause a fire because there was a Coleman, it was known that they'd been using Coleman lanterns for days to light the building. I find an inconsistency between the efforts of the gas insertion plan to save life and the actions of this tank repeatedly going in and out, crushing that section of the building. And my specific question is, was the Attorney General warned of this part of the plan and what was its purpose?
A couple of you may respond. I don't know who's best, Mr. Potts, Mr. Clark, whoever has the best response to that.
Well, I believe that there was a discussion that there may come a point in this where we would try to poke holes in the building.
I understood that.
Yes, sir.
This I don't see as a hole.
No, I understand that. Yes, sir. But I believe that the CEV, according to what the HRT drivers said about that day, was trying to get around to get gas into the back of that compound, which they could not get to any other way. And I do not believe that there were any bodies found in that area.
The closest bodies were found a little further in.
Yes, sir.
Each one of those five bodies, it's reported, had extensive, according to the autopsy report, extensive body mutilation. Now, I don't know.
Time has expired. They can respond. I think, Mr. Clark, or you have a right to have two responses here under our kind of ground rules. Mr. Clark, would you be the appropriate one to respond in addition to that?
Was the attorney, I believe the question in part was the attorney general informed of the prospect of this type of damage? That type of question.
Have you all been made available of the briefing book that we prepared for the attorney general dated April the 12th?
Yes, we have.
Did you read it?
It's not this report?
No, it's a briefing book.
There's a briefing book for the attorney general.
No, sir.
Well, I'd suggest you read it.
Thank you, sir.
Well, let me explain that what it said in there is that the part of the plan, as this thing extended on, was after 48 hours, if there were no people coming out, that there would be a systematic dismantling of the building that would take place. The authority delegated to the on-scene commander was that if at any time the Davidians responded and that the lives of the agents were placed in danger, the on-scene commander had full authority to escalate that plan. The decisions for that kind of thing were left to the decision of the person on the scene. That would have been Mr. Jamar, and the destruction of the building was part of that ultimate plan, which was included in that book.
So the Attorney General was aware you could begin to crush the building 6 hours in rather than 48 hours?
I don't think I said that.
There was a question.
Your time has expired. I cannot let you pursue that. Mr. Barr, I believe we're reserving on the right side over here. We only have Mr. Taylor left. Mr. Barr, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Oh, okay, Mr. Chairman. Thank you. Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Taylor does want to go.
Mr. Chairman, if with the chair's approval, I would give 30 seconds of my time to Mr. Conyers and reserve the rest.
You may do that.
Okay.
Mr. Conyers, you're recognized for 30 seconds of Mr. Taylor's time, and I'll clock it here.
Oh, I know you will, Mr. Chairman. Thank you very much. I wanted to return to Mr. Richard because we had a discussion about the administration's position on the exclusionary rule, and I wanted to agree with you that the administration joined us in opposing early on a contract item, H.R. 666, that provides that any evidence discovered as a result of a good faith search is admissible in evidence, which in essence does away with the warrant requirement, because I doubt if anybody's going to come forward and say they weren't in good faith when they found the illegal evidence. But in the anti-terrorism bill, they had there's a section there that deals with search through a wiretap. The bill allows law enforcement agents to obtain a wiretap without a warrant under emergency circumstances if an act of terrorism is involved and it's gone on to be defined. Now, terrorism is...
Let me warn everybody here that I cannot say that you have 30 seconds to ask a question like at the end. The time, the clock is running for the whole 5 minutes.
I'm not asking a question.
30 seconds.
We're over a minute now.
Are you aware of the point that I'm making here on anti-terrorism, Mr. Richards?
I am to this extent, Congressman, that our position with respect to the terrorism bill is, as I've tried to indicate before, we believe consistent with the mandate of the Fourth Amendment. We do believe...
It allows wiretaps where terrorism is involved without a warrant.
Congressman, the current Title III, which is the general wiretap statute, does have an exigent circumstance requirement in it already at this point, which permits, when there are exigent circumstances, the utilization of wiretaps, followed by, within, I think, 24 or 48 hours, notice to the court and submission. And I think it is that approach which we believe is consistent with the Fourth Amendment that is embodied in the terrorism bill.
So you've just said that you are supporting a weakening of the exclusionary rule by allowing terrorism now to be involved in wiretap.
No, on the contrary. The administration's position has been that...
Well, look, stop, please. We'll do this on somebody else's time. You're available when we're not here having hearings on Waco, and I'd like to pursue this discussion with you.
The gentleman consumed 3 minutes of Mr. Taylor's time. He has 2 minutes remaining. I presume he wishes to reserve it. Or do you want it now?
Mr. Chairman, I'm going to hold on to that 2 minutes.
You're going to hold on to it. Very well.
Mr. Cox?
All right. I will yield now down here to Mr. Barr five minutes. You're recognized for 5 minutes, Mr. Barr.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Clark, very briefly, you mentioned some briefing book. It is true, is it not, that the Attorney General has admitted publicly that she didn't read that briefing book?
I am not aware of that.
I can't hear you. You need to use the microphone.
I'm not aware of that.
Okay, well, it is true. It's contained in the Deputy Attorney General's report at page 272. So, you know, my only point is don't lecture us about it. I mean, she didn't read it either.
I think the question
not a question. I don't want to make a big deal out of it. Your implication I don't think was appropriate. I'd like, if I could please, to Mr. Bush, if you could take this photograph, probably Mr. Potts. I'd like to follow on some testimony of yesterday. This is a picture taken immediately after the fire with the rubble still smoldering in the background showing the entry to the bus, the underground bus. And Mr. Bush, if you could show me the photograph that was up there and point out the area right here. Mr. Potts, is the area that Mr. Bush is pointing to the area where that goes into the bus?
I believe so, sir.
Okay.
Yes.
I mean, you're welcome to also. I think that's the area there.
That's fine.
Mr. Bush is pointing to is the entry into the bus.
Right.
And the picture that you have is immediately after the fire, showing I believe, does it not, that all but a very small corner of the bus is covered up with dirt.
I think we may have dug that out.
I'm sorry?
We may have dug that out.
So it may have been completely covered up.
I think it may have been. I just don't know
okay.
for sure.
There is testimony that I'm going to refer to from the court case, criminal action number W93CR046, et cetera, which is the case out of the U.S. District Court for the Western District of Texas. What I'm going to refer to is testimony by one of the government's witnesses, Mr. R.J. Craig, who was driving one of the vehicles that day. And his testimony, for example, after this was during extensive cross-examination, was that, quote, we received instructions to knock the hole in the wall after about 10:30. And then he goes on. The question to him is, but the tunnel, this is the tunnel into the bus from the inside. The tunnel that you were trying to get the CS gas into was lower than the area that where you were dispersing it. And further question, well, you went in to try to stop people from getting into the tunnel area or the bus area to get into that area outside. You've already described that, have you not? And then his answer is, yes, sir. And then there's further discussion. That one was at page 5599 and then at page 5600. The question is, so at the end of that building, this is where you expected there would be an entryway into the bus. And then he says, yes, sir. And then a further question, and that's why you were directed to shoot the CS gas there, right? And he says, that's correct. And then a final question. And a final answer, to put gas in the hallway of the building to prevent people from coming down the hall and getting into the bus. The question is, that to me seems absolutely directly at odds with testimony yesterday, and I don't think it was yours, correct me if I'm wrong, but testimony directly from witnesses yesterday that one of the purposes to allow especially the kids to get out was knowing the bus was at least somewhat separated from the building. There was a trap door from the building into the bus, and that every effort was made to hopefully sort of herd the kids towards that location so they could go through the trap door into the bus. And then the agent said one of the first places they went to afterwards was going into the bus, which it appears from that is completely covered up with dirt so that you couldn't get into the bus. So the question is really twofold. Can you explain the inconsistency? I mean, it just seems to me that this government witness in the court case who was driving one of the vehicles, inserting the gas, says very clearly several times that his instructions were to gas that part of the building first by the trap door to prevent people from going through the trap door to get into the bus. Is his testimony correct? And why is there this seeming direct inconsistency?
I'm not sure that there is a consistency, and I'll do my best to answer your question, Mr. Barr. I'm not sure I'm the best one to do it because the people on site would be a lot more effective at knowing where the tunnel was and how they could get into it. I think that it's true that that was one of the first places that was gassed, and it was...
Excuse me, while you're answering that, Mr. Bush, if you could put up the schematic which shows the trapdoor itself right by the underground bus and point that out. I'm sorry, Mr. Potts.
I think it's true that it was one of the first places that was gassed, and part of that thinking was to prevent people, to move people toward the center of the compound. We were going to do this on an incremental basis and just move them toward the center. We still held out a lot of hope, even because of the length of time. You're talking about 6 hours from the time that this operation began until the fire started. We still held out a lot of hope that even though that area had been gassed, that they would go through that area, put the children through that area and down into the bus,
but
which
his did
testimony have cool,
is that,
clean
that,
air.
That he was instructed to insert gas there by the trapdoor to prevent people from getting to the bus.
It would move them toward the middle, yes, sir. But it's not going to prevent them on a long-term basis after 6 hours later with that kind of ventilation from going.
How would you get people
in.
To escape by herding them to the center of the compound?
As I said, we hoped that the immediate reaction might be that some people would come out, but this was not an operation where we expected to put some CS gas into a room right away and have a lot of people come out. We were trying to shrink the size of the compound. The other thing we were hoping to do was to force some serious negotiation, to force David to get back on the phone and start talking to us seriously and working toward a final conclusion that would have all of them come out without any more gassing at all, if possible. That was the hope.
Mr. Barr, your time has expired. Mr. Bowyer, Mr. Ehrlich? Mr. Bowyer. Mr. Bowyer, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Hubbell, on the end of April 15th, I mean, you were painting quite a picture here from a phone conversation that you had with the men on the ground at Waco with regard to people getting tired, tempers are fraying. I mean, all of this leads to the funneling effect towards, geez, some decision must be made here. We've got the military advisors telling Janet Reno that you should pull the team off. I also noted by some of the interviews, FBI really appears to be applying a lot of implicit pressures and explicit pressures into the equations by saying, around April 12th, advising the Attorney General that he crashed, he's beating the babies. I mean, there's a lot of things here are being put into a decision-making equation that is placing a lot of stress on an Attorney General who's not necessarily too happy about the plan. Matter of fact, on April 16th, in your conversations here, according to Richard and Hubbell, Hubbell advised him that the Attorney General had disapproved the plan to end the FBI standoff. There got to be some people that are really ticked off here that the attorney, you're smiling. It must be true.
No, I wouldn't say that, Congressman. What I would say is that the FBI and it was unanimous, believed that this was the only way to get the children out safely. And
well,
they believed in their plan, and they were certainly going to give us every reason they believed it would work. I believe that it was my job and other people's jobs to understand that and evaluating
Mr. Hubbell,
the decision.
Richard's response to you is the FBI would not be pleased. So I think we can read a lot into that. Let me make one other comment. I'm going to yield then to Mr. Bryan of Tennessee. And And that is, we all understand, whether we're here in the political world, it doesn't make any difference in what world we're in here in the United States, we understand about the aspects of responsibility and authority. And I will submit there's one thing that has become very bothersome to me, and that is I have great respect for those who are in the field. Someone referred to it as a thin blue line the other day. We have tremendous respect. What bothers me tremendously are the politicos in this one, the political appointees. Either they're saying, well, geez, either I didn't have the authority, I was only enacting at the time, or it was outside my jurisdiction, or geez, if someone had given me better data or information, I could have made a great intelligent decision, so that briefing may not have been there. So it's almost like, geez, I wasn't in control at the time, but I sure am now, and it'll never happen again.
Congressman, so I'm not aware of any political employee involved in this other than myself and the Attorney General, and I believe we both take responsibility for what happened.
Right, I think that's important. The other thing that's important is when Janet Reno says, I assume all full responsibility, the buck stops with me, I think that's absolutely wrong because she works for somebody and we know who that is. Mm-hmm. And it's the chief executive officer of the land. I yield the balance of my time to the gentleman from Tennessee.
Very quickly, I want to follow up if I could. I think Mr. Clark raises a very good point with regard to the question Mr. Shattuck raised, and I want to follow up on that. What I understand had happened, General Reno had given approval for the gas plan on the 17th after changing her mind. She said that as a part of this plan that if the gas didn't work for 48 hours, then the vehicles, the tanks could begin a systematic opening up or disassembly of the building. And that she did in fact give the on-site commander, Mr. Jamar, authority to make decisions on that if something happened. And I accept that. I think that's legitimate. And there's no question about it that 6 hours into this 48 hours, in fact, around 10:30 their time, 11:30 this time, the FBI did begin to move to disassemble the building, as Mr. Shattuck so clearly pointed out. My question, though, is that this is a major shift. You've jumped ahead 42 hours in your strategic plan. This is a major change. You're tearing down the building at that point, at least parts of it. And Ms. Reno, I think, had left the strategy session. At that point, she had a commitment to go to Maryland to give a speech. Now, she's en route up there or giving a speech. My question is, what efforts, and she retained, by the way, throughout this, the authority to stop at any point, stop this plan at any point. Did she not? She did. She did. Was she advised of this major change 42 hours in advance that y'all were now going in to tear this building down or at least parts of it? Was she notified? Did she have a car phone? I'm sure she had, there were ways to contact her. Did anyone contact her to let her know this?
I may be wrong timing-wise, and somebody may help me. I believe that some of the destruction of the building had occurred before she left to go to give that speech. The decision was made, she didn't want to go make that speech, but the decision was made that they thought that if she didn't go give that speech, that would be some indication, but I wanted to tell you,
and I'm not being critical. I didn't mean to be critical that she was given
that was
a speech.
That was tactical.
I'm just saying, you know, she had the authority to call off that raid at any point.
Yes, she did.
I'm wondering, was she aware that y'all were advancing the plan very, very quickly?
I believe that there had been destruction of the building before she left. Now,
Mr.
Floyd,
Mr.
or Larry, you might know better than I.
Has expired, Mr. Bryant. Go ahead.
Yeah, Mr. Bryant, I don't recall the exact sequence of events and the timing of them, but in terms of this being a major shift, I would probably characterize it a little bit differently because it was part of the overall plan with Mr. Jamar having the authority to move that up. And Mr. Hubble points out that almost in the beginning, when the tanks came under fire, that they were putting holes in the front of the building. Our monitoring of this was via television that was available to all of the public, and we could see that there was some destruction occurring throughout this process. So it to me, was not a major shift from the natural progression of the plan.
Thank you, Mr. Bryant. Mr. Condit, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Yes, I have a quick question for Mr. Potts, and I appreciate the panel. I know most things have been asked here already, but yesterday or a couple days ago, all these hearings are kind of running into each other, but I asked the FBI about the possibility of a fire plan, and I think in your bio you said that they would not sign off on the fire plan or sign off on the raid had there not been a fire plan. Was the fire plan followed?
The fire plan that is written up did not. They notified the fire departments. They had gotten a list of the fire departments. They had checked on their availability. They had checked on the amount of time that it would take for them to get to the scene. And so I think in that respect that it was. Of course, the problem was even once the fire trucks arrived, they couldn't be allowed to go to the scene to fight it.
Well, was there any anticipation, and forgive me if you've said this in your bio, any anticipation because of the prophecy of Mr. Koresh that there would be fire and blood and explosion, that there, you know, that maybe we ought to have had something that would anticipate that so we could have stopped the fire?
You know, sir, we talked extensively about what was available. We even had our liaison officer with the Department of Defense check with them to see if there was some kind of armored vehicle that could be used as a firefighting. We talked about planes that could drop water, and we were afraid if there was a fire and there was water that was dropped, it would crash the roof. And so, I mean, it was the best we could do was the fire departments that were available was done.
So I've got to yield to my good friend from Mississippi, but maybe I can get a yes or no on this. So the fire plan was not followed, or was it followed?
No, sir, it was followed.
It was followed, okay. I've come down here to yield to my good friend from Mississippi the rest of my time, and I do appreciate your response. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Condon. And Mr. Potts, I had the opportunity last night to read your testimony, and I was at another hearing yesterday, so please forgive me if I'm being redundant. But I would like to clarify on the day of the second raid, the day of the last raid, did the FBI fire one shot, even one shot at the Davidian compound?
Not throughout the entire standoff.
The vehicles, the heavy armored vehicles that are shown, were they armed with anything other than tear gas grenades?
No, sir. As a matter of fact, when they first arrived, we had the barrels taken off and told David that these were not offensive weapons that we were bringing in.
How about, who was driving them? Were they military people driving them?
No, sir. We had no military people driving them. We had to put our hostage rescue team people through a crash course on learning to drive those vehicles.
Okay. Mr. Chairman, I would like to submit for the record a DOD memo that outlines that the vehicles were going to be transferred. Maintenance would be paid for by the FBI. There would be FBI people driving them, and that they would not be armed.
Without objection.
Thank you. I'm further interested in a statement that you made, and it's a pretty strong statement, so I want you to repeat it, if you feel comfortable repeating it. The autopsies revealed that no one was harmed by the tear gas or had toxic levels of any component of tear gas in their systems. Who are we referring to, sir?
Pardon me, I'm sorry.
This is from your statement.
Right.
Who are you referring to in that statement? It's on page 11 of your statement.
That no one inside the compound had.
So you're talking about the Davidians?
Yes, sir.
I'm perplexed by something you said a little bit earlier, because we keep hearing about 20 children. But you'd said something to the effect that Koresh implied they were all, at this point, these were all his biological children?
On March 5th, we got our last child out, even though we continued throughout to get more out. And on March, I believe it was the 7th or 8th, somewhere in there, he indicated, when we were talking to him about sending more children out, he said, no, you're talking about my biological children now. That's different.
So in addition to everything else he did, he used his own biological children as human shields to keep law enforcement from serving a legal warrant on him and arresting him for firearms violations, compiling a hit list of former members, possibility of illegal aliens there, child molestation that could go into statutory rape, holding people there against his will. Am I correct in saying
yes,
that?
Yes, sir, you are.
I believe this is the same panel we've had before us, right? Everyone's been at the table? Okay, so then I'm going to ask you the same question I've asked everybody else. Is there anything that you've seen or heard or read justify murder of those four ATF agents at the hands of David Koresh and his followers, or in any way absolve David Koresh from direct responsibility for the deaths of those 80 people who died at his compound?
No.
No, sir.
Would you state your names for the record and then?
Floyd Clark, the answer is no.
Mark Richard, the answer is resoundingly no.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Chairman, I reserve still my 2 minutes.
So noted. Mr. Ehrlich, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Hubble, I have just one quick general question for you, sir. You have watched these hearings, or you're certainly familiar with what's been going on. You've seen the give and take with respect to the issue of the propriety of these hearings. Sir, my question to you is it your opinion that these proceedings, these hearings, constitute a legitimate exercise of this body's oversight authority?
I do believe it is a legitimate exercise, and if anything comes out of these hearings that will help prevent what happened, that's worthwhile. Prevent it from happening again is the way I would like to put it. The Attorney General has always said, the only thing we can do, we can't engage in recrimination, but we can engage in trying to determine what we could do to prevent this from happening again.
Sir, I appreciate your forthright answer, and with that, I will yield to Mr. Chabot.
Gentlemen, Mr. Clark, before when Mr. Shattuck was asking some questions, you referred to the briefing book relative to the tank going in and tearing off the back of that building. Is this the briefing book that you were talking about here?
It is not.
April 19th briefing book, this is not it?
That is not
okay,
it.
Okay, Mr. Hubble, let me ask you some questions, sir. Mr. Hubble, in the scraps of paper that are being referred to as the Vincent Foster suicide note, is this sentence, FBI lied in their report to the AG, I assume meaning Attorney General. Now, there's been some speculation in the press that this sentence may have been related to the Travelgate affair, as originally thought, but not to the Travelgate affair, but perhaps to Waco. And you knew Mr. Foster well. Do you have any sense of what Mr. Foster was referring to there?
Yes, I do.
And what
Mr.
do you think
Foster believed that the FBI had not been truthful in reporting to the Attorney General about a conversation the FBI had with Mr. Kennedy relating to the travel office. It had nothing to do with Waco, Congressman.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Potts, as Mr. Condit referred to a little bit ago, you were aware that there was not going to be any firefighting equipment actually at the compound prior to the final assault. Is that right?
That would have been obviously the preference, a decision by the on-scene commander.
Well, there wasn't any firefighting equipment.
There was not. That's
okay,
right.
Now, time's kind of short, so
I've
got to keep them relatively short. Now, this was basically because of concern, the FBI being concerned that the people driving firefighting equipment might be fired upon. Is that right?
You mean as to why they were not there before, as
yeah,
the operation
didn't have,
started?
The FBI didn't have firefighting equipment prior to the attack because they were concerned that the Davidians might shoot at the people in the firefighting trucks, correct?
That's correct, yes, sir.
All right. Yet yesterday, it's my recollection that you said that you were not expecting any gunfire in that assault. Isn't that right?
I indicated that I thought that the plan we had come up with significantly reduced the likelihood of us being fired on immediately when we started the operation.
Okay, so I think the answer is yes.
That's
okay. Now, in planning very large actions of this sort, like the going in at the building, you do a lot of planning, like if this happens, then this, we'll do this, and if this happens, then we'll do this, correct?
Yes, sir.
Now, didn't you consider, or did you consider that fire might well occur in this instance, and if it does, we do this?
Yes, sir. We did.
But it obviously didn't work.
Sir, I think that the information we have from the fire commanders is that they, even if they'd gotten in there much, much earlier, there's nothing they could have done. First of all, we couldn't put them in there earlier because shots were still coming out of the compound, and the safety of the firemen, they would not have been safe. And secondly, even if...
Okay, my time's relatively short. Let me get to Mr. Hubble. Thank you. Mr. Hubble, relative
I think you said before you expected the Davidians, particularly mothers who had kids in there, to come out when the CS gas was pumped in there, correct?
That's correct.
Now, were you familiar with Mrs. Sparks, who she was, the lady, the Child Protective Service lady who'd been in and talked to Koresh a number of times?
I believe I had read a report from her.
Did you know before that happened?
No.
Before the assault?
Read the report.
Did you know of her existence and what she had to say?
I knew of her existence in a report.
Prior to the assault?
Yes.
Okay, and you're aware that her view, were you aware, sir, Mr. Potts, were you aware?
Which view? I'm sorry.
Were you aware of Mrs. Sparks, the child, and what her view was of Koresh and the folks in there? Mm-hmm. And were you both aware of the fact that she, in her opinion, the Davidians had this, it was a very unusual religion. I think we all agree with that. But they were basically, they thought they had this apocalyptic view of things and that we mean the United States government, I wasn't in Congress at the time, so I wasn't part of the government at that time, but the Babylonian United States government was going to come after him sometime, and they were all going to die and either go to heaven or whatever. And you all were aware they basically had a different mindset than that. Yet we thought that when we pumped the CS gas in there, they'd just come walking out with their kids.
I didn't think they'd come walking out. I think if you had listened to, like I did and others, to the Defense Department talking about the effects that the gas would have on adult males and what would happen, they were quite convincing to me that the women and the children and some of the males would come running out of that compound.
Gas was so bad. So on the one hand, it was so bad that it did these things to men, but then on the other hand, we always are downplaying what it would have done to the kids. You can't have it both ways.
I believe that the assumption was that it would have the same effect, that the children and the women and the men would come out of the compound as a result of the insertion of the gas. We wouldn't have inserted the gas if we didn't think it would work.
Mr. Shabbat, your time has expired. Mr. Klinger, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, and I would like to yield back my time to you.
Thank you very much. Mr. Clark, I have examined what appears to be your post-event interview by the normal investigative internal processes that were done over at the agency, the FBI, in July of 93. And it appears to me that you had some early misgivings about the gas insertion plan, that you later became convinced of it. But in that process, trying not to read the whole statement here, you seem to be willing to accept it based primarily on your concern or desire to see this as a go-slow process, that is, the extended 48-hour plan rather than the let's go do it all at one time like the military may have suggested they would have done it in a military operation. And ultimately that was obviously accepted. You also expressed some concern about the firing of projectiles at one point into the compound. Could you tell us why you were concerned about the do-it-fast plan, why you preferred this extended plan, why you eventually accepted the extended plan but were hesitant on the other?
I think Mr. Chairman, I think that the FBI's position on this from day one was to be very deliberate, very careful, and not to do anything that would be provocative, that would cause some reaction. Anything that we might do might be misinterpreted by those inside. And I think you've probably heard testimony that before there would be movement of these CEVs, that the negotiators would call in and tell the people inside ahead of time before they were moved, so that we didn't do anything that would send a signal that could be interpreted or misinterpreted as any kind of aggressive action on our part that may cause them to react in a way that caused the situation to escalate. So the plan all along was consistent with that thinking. And as we developed the plan for using the CS, we wanted it to follow that same kind of thinking. So an incremental, deliberate, giving advance notice, giving ample opportunity without any unnecessary provocation that we would bring about a peaceful solution.
You were afraid that with the provocation, if it occurred, if it were interpreted that way as aggressive, they might either try to break out and have some confrontation that would result in death or suicide or whatever. You didn't know a fire might be started, obviously, but was that, I mean, I'm just trying to get the reason why you didn't want to provoke them.
I think it was, well, I mean, we had already the February 28th as an example, and it was very difficult to predict with any degree of accuracy what they might do.
Suicide was considered remote at the final point in time, according to all the reports, but that was a consideration, was it not?
I think we tried to consider every possible option or alternative that they
Again, that's part of why you didn't want to act aggressively, why you wanted the delayed, the implemented plan. Now, but at the end, you accepted a plan which had an acceleration feature in it, and obviously we all know that it was accelerated and these projectiles were fired and it was condensed. And that is something I gather was done reluctantly, but what I guess I'm getting at is at the time that this whole thing occurred and the projectiles were fired and all of this happened, were you aware that Mr. Jamar had expressed, at least he's felt it, he expressed it to us here the other day, an opinion that it was a 99% likelihood that the vehicles that were going to insert this gas would in fact succumb to fire, and that if they succumbed to fire as part of the plan, there would have been an acceleration. And therefore, were you aware that Jamar thought that? Mr. Potts said yesterday he wasn't aware of that.
I haven't had a chance to talk to Mr. Jamar about that, and I'm not sure that that feeling or position is a retrospective or prospective assessment. I can tell you that in our conversations with Mr. Jamar on the 7th and 8th, that he did not voice that. And I think that the caution and concern that I was outlining for you was shared by all of the people.
Well, I think,
and I think that we, especially after the activity that had taken place on the 18th, that we believed that there was a great likelihood that they would not respond with gunfire.
Could you describe for us, before my time expires, your opinion about how long the hostage rescue team could have remained deployed before it would need to undergo rest and retraining? After the 19th of April, I mean, that was right. The day, obviously, this happened, but how much longer?
I think that we probably had a couple of weeks, maybe a little bit longer. In talking with both Dick Rogers as well as his people that worked for him when we were out there, I think that if you would have asked the HRT people themselves, I think they would have told you that they could have continued. I think that the judgment of the superiors was that it was getting to a point in time where they would need to be pulled out and to refurbish their training. We were making plans to do that. If, in fact, this was not an accepted plan, we were looking at putting SWAT teams in to replace them. But I have to also add that when you do that, you greatly reduce the ability to protect yourself and place the replacement agents and personnel in a higher level of danger for a lot of reasons. And I won't go into those, but there are some tactical reasons in terms of the familiarity with how they were monitoring what was happening, their ability to use certain weapons that were in the inventory of the HRT that were not available, nor were the SWAT team people trained to use them to combat the similar kinds of weapons inside. So you were increasing the risk to the agents, but We were formulating plans to do that if we had to do that.
But how much time did you think they had before you'd have to do that?
2 or 3 weeks, probably.
Thank you very much. I would now normally recognize Mr. Taylor. He's the only one remaining on your side, and we only have me over here. Do we know if Mr. Taylor is back there, coming back for his 2 minutes?
I think he stepped out just briefly. Is it possible we reserve his time? Is there anyone on the other side?
There's nobody else over here but me, and I'm going to. You have time left?
I think he has.
All right, then I yield to Mr. Zeller for 5 minutes.
Thank you very much. Mr. Clark, thank you. I think you helped solve one of our problems. We've been trying to get these briefing books. You indicated this is not the briefing book in question. Am I correct?
Correct.
And in the 302s indicated there were two books. We have not been able to, just now, thanks to you, been able to get this from your department. We've asked for it. We haven't been able to get it. We now have it, and thank you. This is part of the problem here of trying to be able to get to the bottom of this thing. There's so much stuff out there. You know, like on February 28th, the ATF took films of every day, except that day the stuff's missing, and so this is very, very helpful. I guess the paragraph that I'd like to read on page 26, if all subjects fail to surrender after 48 hours of tear gas, then a CEV with a modified blade will commence a systematic opening up disassembly of the building structure until all subjects are located. And I guess my question is, did the AG read this book and that paragraph? And this seems to be the rules of engagement. And since they were modified and we went in 6 hours, what?
I think there's more to that, Mr. Chairman, and I can't answer your question about whether the AG read it or not.
Okay, so we don't know whether she read the rules of engagement. We don't know whether she was told about the change in the rules of engagement, 48 hours to 6.
I don't think there was any change.
But, in fact, that tank and the blade and the removal, that section of the building.
I think there's another section in there, if you look, and I don't recall what
section. We will read it, but could you?
I think you and I have a different interpretation of what that says.
Do you have a page number or reference? We could have staff take a quick look at it. While you're doing that, let me ask.
I was just informed also, Mr. Chairman, that the book was provided to the committee some time ago.
So it just got disappeared maybe in the 48,000 pieces of paper that we got that was unorganized and unassembled.
You probably understand perhaps the dilemma that we have to go through.
I'm sure. That's government at its worst, I guess. Mr. Hubble, you're a close friend of the president. Is that correct?
That's correct.
And a golfing buddy?
We play golf together, yes, Congressman.
And I'm not asking scores or anything like that. Do you socialize with the president?
I used to.
I'm not sure I understand. Do you spend any time, did you spend any time at all between the 15th, 16th, and 17th, and 18th with him?
I cannot answer that question.
That's the month of April. Well, let me try to go back. You had a two-hour conversation with Mr. Sage as far as Waco is concerned. Right. And I guess what I'm wondering is if this close relationship of yours, I mean, if you're these kind of buddies, is there any way at all that and I looked at the same thing with Mr. Altman's letter to Mr. Benson on April 15th. Here's two major players here that are both involved in something that could blow up, literally. And the subject never came up in any discussions. You never pick up the phone. You never talked to him. You never told him.
On official business, I communicated with the president through the White House counsel.
That's interesting. Didn't you feel compelled to pick up the phone?
Well, I was confident that the White House counsel was telling the president what I was reporting to the White House counsel.
But how did you know?
I have great confidence in Mr. Nussbaum, Mr. Foster, and Mr. Lindsey.
Well, I just think that here's a case where we're going ahead with a plan that's going to affect almost 100 Americans, that we're going to gas a situation that ended up with disastrous results. And I just find a person who is as close as you are, you wouldn't pick up the phone and...
Oh, if you remember right, it wasn't until, I believe, Friday or Saturday that the decision was made to go ahead. And at that point, the Attorney General did call the President of the United States, and I was in the room when she made that call.
Okay, but you spent 2 hours with Mr. Sage getting an up-to-date briefing, including the apparent surrender plan, or whatever you would refer that to, and 2 hours on the phone on the 15th. And you didn't tell anything to the president until the 19th when you didn't, I guess you let him know that.
I did not talk to the president about Waco prior to the 19th. And on any basis. I communicated through the White House counsel, but I did brief the White House counsel about my conversations with Mr. Sage.
Mm-hmm. And did President call you back?
No, I didn't call him.
I mean, okay, but you briefed him through the counsel. You assume that the counsel briefed him.
Yeah.
He then did nothing?
He talked to the Attorney General herself on the 18th.
I yield back to the chairman for the last 30 seconds.
Well, I just have one question that I want to follow with Mr. Clark in that 30 seconds. Mr. Clark, a minute ago you'd indicated in the time that you had an opportunity to think about this that you did not have any awareness of Mr. Jamar's conclusion that it was 99% likelihood that the vehicles would be fired on when they put the gas in prior to it happening. And, of course, we both concur that what Mr. Jamar said, and he said it yesterday, that the plan called for an acceleration of that gas being inserted if that eventuality occurred. Had you been aware Jamar felt that way, had he informed you prior to the 19th, would you have informed the Attorney General of that? Was that significant enough an opinion that you would have passed that on to her?
I think all through this operation, Mr. Chairman, was that we tried to ensure to the fullest of our capabilities that the Department of Justice and the Attorney General was aware of every detail.
But that would have, my point is that would have been significant enough, you would have passed it on to her.
Every detail.
Would it have caused you to have changed your opinion?
I would have explored that with him to try to understand his rationale. The fact is that we had those discussions and it did not come up in those discussions.
I understand that. Very well. 2 minutes yielded to Mr. Taylor. You have 2 minutes left, Mr. Taylor.
Okay,
I will time the 2 minutes. We can't.
Okay. Mr. Chairman, it's my understanding that Ms. Thurman was going to give
Ms.
me two.
Ms. Thurman's going to get time. Do you want the time first?
Actually,
you've got 7 minutes on your side. I'm going to yield you 7 minutes.
Yield me seven,
I'll yield
and I
you
will
seven,
yield
and
them.
You determine how to run
okay,
it. We'll run our clock. We'll just add 2 minutes before we start the clock running. We'll let 2 minutes go by.
Mr. Chairman. She's going to give me two plus my two. That gives me four. Cut me off.
I was getting ready to just yield you 4 minutes.
Oh, I'll settle for two. Okay.
I'll give you four.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
First 2 minutes right now.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to go back and again, Mr. Potts, I apologize that Armed Services was meeting yesterday. So I might be redundant, but I don't think I am. You say in your statement, and this is, I take it, a sworn testimony that you've given to this committee, that at 12.07 p.m., the Davidians set simultaneous fires at three or more locations within the compound. It was established by teams of independent arson experts and fire department analysis experts from electronic surveillance overhears, by videotape taken from aircraft, by observations from FBI agents, and by admissions of Davidian survivors. You stand by that statement?
Yes, sir.
There is no doubt in your mind that those fires were set by anyone other than the Davidians?
No, sir, absolutely no doubt.
And that three fires were set simultaneously by the Davidians?
Yes, sir.
By a prearranged plan?
That's okay. Correct.
I would, Mr. Hubbell, since we were cut off last time, you could not answer the question I've asked every other panel. But I want to ask you as well. Because you've obviously studied this issue a lot. Is there anything that you've seen or read or heard justify the murder of those four ATF agents, the wounding of 20 more, and I've been taking it a step further, in any way negate the guilt of David Koresh in the death of those 80 people? 80
no.
People he could have said, get up and leave, and they would have left.
No, Congressman, not at all. Nothing.
Okay. Ms. Thurman, thank you very much. I yield back the balance of my time to Ms. Thurman.
That I will yield to Mr. Scott 2 minutes.
Thank you. Dr. Salem, I'm going to be a little bit redundant just so we can nail this down on the safety of CS gas. Obviously, anybody subjected to that will be very much traumatized while they're subjected to it, but you indicated that there are no documented cases of death as a result of exposure to CS gas. Is that right? Are there any citations of medical problems lasting more than 30 days for adults or children from exposure to CS gas that you're aware of?
No, sir.
Does CS gas cause skin to burn?
It causes skin irritation, which is exacerbated if it's wet.
And how long does that last?
That depends on the severity of the burn.
Will it cause blistering?
Not usually. In some rare cases, it may. I believe there is one instance of that that's been recorded.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back the balance of the time to Ms. Thurman.
At this time, I would yield to Ms. Jackson Lee.
Ms. Thurman, I thank you very much, and I had asked a question of Director Sessions, Mr. Hubbell, and I had not got a chance to pursue with you. Let me welcome you and acknowledge that this is not a question of an indictment. This is a question for information. I do recall, however, tragically, under the leadership or under the time that President Ronald Reagan served this nation well, that 265 young men lost their lives in their sleep in Lebanon. I would imagine that there were officials that made decisions that might have augmented that tragedy. Even though they were military personnel, they were asleep. My question is that we have been confronted with a very serious question of cover-up. Cover-up to the extent that you play golf with the president, you're a friend of the president, and I'll maintain that today. But that why didn't he know, or why is the blame not being placed at the door of the White House? I do think we can fix some things in the system in terms of how many times we review a decision like that. But help me understand, if you can recount again, that process where you would not place the blame at the president and whether or not there was a cover-up.
Well, let me first say there is no cover-up. I've never seen an issue examined like this Waco situation. There are reports after reports, and that's fine. But first of all, I did not talk to the president about this. The attorney general did. I don't place the blame of what happened in Waco on these good people who are here at this table. Who killed those people was David Koresh or Vernon Howe. We live with those decisions that we made. We wish we had some of them back. But we were, I hope that David Koresh was a master of manipulation. And I hope if people try to place the blame on the deaths of those children and women in the compound on somebody other than David Koresh, I believe they are continually being manipulated again by David Koresh. He is the one who murdered those people. It's sad. We live with it. We dream about it. But the blame lies at the feet of David Koresh, not the President of the United States, not the Attorney General, not the people who are at this table. But I will tell you, I take responsibility for some of those decisions that were made to go into that compound. I was responsible. Other people at this table were responsible. The Attorney General was responsible. And we wish we had tried something else, knowing what we know now. But the blame lies at the feet of David Koresh, not the President of the United States and not the Attorney General of the United States.
I'm gaining my time.
Thank you very much.
Mr. Clark, very quickly, did you get an answer, or did you get a chance to answer Mr. Zella for what the difference in the interpretation was as he saw it compared to what you saw?
Yes, the clarification is that once the people in Waco came under fire, or that the lives of the people in this operation were placed in jeopardy because of actions by the people inside, the on-scene commander had full authority and full discretion to do whatever in his judgment was necessary to provide for their protection in response to that.
Mr. Chairman, at this time, you all have talked to a great extent about the problems with the documents and the 23,000 or 30,000 pieces. I just need to make a very quick announcement of some interns that we'd like to thank on our side that helped us go through those documents as well, and this is their last day today. So if I could thank Dean Atkins, Michael Deaver, Stephanie Fried, Saviero Grazioglio Veneer, Dan
McElhenney,
Yasumi Sanchez, and John Stevens. We just want to acknowledge the work that they did in trying to put this information together for us.
Thank you very much. I believe everybody else has asked all their questions, and I have 5 minutes left to yield to myself. I want to make a couple of questions that relate to the SAGE conversation with you, Mr. Hubbell, on the 15th of April. I think that was a fairly decisive two-hour discussion. Is my understanding correct that Mr. Potts, Mr. Richards, and Mr. Clark were all participants in that conversation? You all were listening in, or was this a speakerphone? Can somebody tell me if you were?
I believe it was. Yeah.
Speakerphone. So you heard everything Mr. Hubbell heard, right?
That's correct. There were additional people in on that conversation.
Mr. Keeney, I got down, was according to the Justice Department report. Is that correct?
That's correct.
So there was a group of you around there, but four of you who were there are sitting out there today. Do any of the other three of you, Potts, Richards, or Clark, have any recollections of that conversation that would differ from the conclusions Mr. Hubbell gave us on the points we asked about, particularly pertaining to Mr. Sage's conclusions that the attorney's efforts at negotiating in the end were really no more than additional manipulation by David Koresh, and that he didn't think there was any hope in the negotiations at this point? I mean, that's the flavor we have. I'm trying to summarize it fairly.
That is certainly the gist of my recollection of the conversation. In essence, that we haven't been able to negotiate anything during this course. The course of efforts on the standoff to resolve the standoff, that we were in essence stymied by this. He's a manipulator, and it's going nowhere.
Mr. Clark, that's just of your recollection as well.
Yes, and one additional piece that I think it also was brought up, that this was not the first time that Mr. DeGuerin and Mr. Zimmerman had assurances from Mr. Koresh that he was going to give up. I believe there were some conversations in early April that Koresh indicated that sometime between the 2nd and the 10th or something like that, that he was also going to give up. So this was just more of the same.
And Mr. Ponce, you've already testified to some extent yesterday about this. Was there anything else you'd add to that?
No, sir. It's the same.
Question for you. Did any of the four of you, Hubbell, Potts, Richard, or Clark, recall at any time Mr. Sage saying to you specifically that DeGuerin had indicated to him that he believed, that is, DeGuerin believed that he could bring, that Koresh would come out, that he was within 10 to 15 days of the 14th, which was the day before when the whole discussion had taken place with Sage over the latest developments? Did any of you, do any of you remember Sage saying that to you or not saying it to you? Was that material even?
It would have been material, as everything that was said was material. I have some recollection of him talking about that DeGuerin thought that he would ultimately come out. I do that, but I don't specifically remember anything.
A timetable, right. Yeah. Mr. Potts, do you remember
a timetable? Same. I can't think of any that much particularity.
Right. Mr. Richard, do you remember?
No, I can't add
Mr.
anything.
Mr. Clark, do you?
I can't add
it. All right. No, my point to you is, had that been conveyed to you, that DeGuerin felt passionately that things had really changed, this time it was really different, and that Koresh would come out in 10 to 15 days because the attitude had totally changed, that he was no longer thinking he was the martyr but now the messenger, which is what we've been told by DeGuerin, would that have made any difference to you and your state of mind at that point of time? Would your advice to the Attorney General have been any different, any of you? I don't want to...
Chairman, you put a little different flavor on it when you said the attitude had changed.
If that had been conveyed to you, I'm not assuming that it had. I'm asking you, in your state of mind at that time, based on what you knew, if that had been conveyed to you, would your advice to the Attorney General have been any different, and would you have conveyed that fact to him?
I would have explored it with Mr. Sage.
All right. What about you, Mr. Potts?
I simply would look to Mr. Sage, who's talking to him every day, for his evaluation of whether there'd been an attitudinal change, as opposed to just the attorney.
But the fact that it alone would not have been sufficient.
That's right.
Mr. Richard?
I would have looked like Mr. Potts to the assessment of the negotiators. Was this a serious change by Koresh, or was it just
so
more
it really wouldn't have mattered if Mr. Sage had said it wasn't? It wouldn't have made any difference. Mr. Clark?
I would have reacted the same way. I would have explored that possibility with others, that I would have balanced their judgment with his, maybe not just limited to Mr. Sage, but others that would be in a position to give that input.
Well, let me make a comment or two here in the final conclusions of your panel. I think that you all did a very thorough evaluation. You did it honestly. You did it in your best judgment, and you gave, obviously, the Attorney General your best judgment on the assault with the CS gas. I must say that there are some things that still trouble me. One of them is the fact that Mr. Jamar's feelings about this, particularly his feelings that the 99% certainty that this would result in firing on the vehicles, and in turn we all knew and you all knew that would accelerate, and he knew that would accelerate the CS gas plan. The fact he never said it apparently to any of you, and it never got back to the AG, and it wasn't part of the deliberation proceedings, in light of the fact that most seem to know, and Mr. Clark, you've expressed particular concern that the more aggressive assault, which did in fact take place as a result of the firing on these vehicles and the failure of the people to come out, would and did result in potentially what exactly happened, a reaction that was very negative. So I'm disturbed by that. I think we all should be, and I think you should be. Secondly, I believe that in summary here today, my only other thought is that I do not know the value of what Mr. DeGuerin had to say in terms of his final thing. I can understand why you wouldn't give it weight, why Mr. Sage didn't. You were only giving what weight he did. But it seemed very impassioned, and obviously he genuinely believed it, and it is disturbing that it was not given more weight by Mr. Sage, but maybe it's understandable. What doesn't seem to me, in all of this I've heard to date, and we're going to have more testimony, seemed that all that reasonable, though, was the assumption that these parents who devoted themselves to Koresh, who were taught that the outside world was Babylon and that an FBI attack was the beginning of the apocalyptic end, would pick up their infants and run out of the compound when the CS gas was fired. It seems to me that it would be more reasonable for you to have assumed that they would pick up their suffering children, put, as Mr. Hyde said yesterday, put wet rags over their mouths, hide in the most remote places they could find, and simply wait, which apparently is something like that's what they did. I think, of course, that all goes and begs the question with respect to whether or not you got the best advice or whether you didn't. And that seems to me to summarize where we are today. We've concluded this panel, and at this point, I thank you very much for your coming today, for participating, and we'll be ready now at this point to proceed with the next panel. Mr. Bryant, your
unanimous consent to attach to the record those two pages, which reflect the phone calls that I referred to.
You without objection,
and
yes.
The AP article.
Without objection.
Mr. Chairman, Barr? I'd like to ask also unanimous consent. There was a photograph that, I don't know whether Mr. Potts still has that. We'd like to insert that in the record as well by unanimous consent. This is the photograph of the entry area into the bus immediately after the fire. And also, Mr. Chairman, rather than introduce a lengthy transcript from the trial, and I'd like the following pages entered in by unanimous consent. These are the pages that I referred to earlier of the trial transcript, pages 1425, 5562, 5563, 5565 to 5568, 5577, 5581 and 5582, 5600 to 5601, and 5616.
Without objection.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, Mr. Scott.
Reserving the right to object.
Reserving the right to object? Very well.
Mr. Barr, could you remind us what those pages refer to?
Okay, this is the trial transcript from the case in the Western District of Texas, the U.S. District Court Waco Division of the criminal case, and these were the pages that I specifically referred to in my questioning of Mr. Potts.
And what was the subject matter?
The subject matter was the spraying of tear gas into the area by the bus and the trapdoor leading to the bus.
Without objection, it is so admitted. I again want to thank this panel. You're excused. We're going to introduce the next panel, but we need, obviously, to clear you out and have them come in. I believe that our fire experts are here, and we will commence the next panel immediately. We're not taking any lunch break other than when we get a vote, because we need to be able to proceed today. I think everybody understood that.
Sure,
absolutely.
I really want to get home.
Possibly. Depends on
I'm
If I could have the other panel here, I see if everybody is here, I could ask if Mr. Potts and others could clear the area and we could bring in our other panel. I would really like to introduce them before we have a vote.
They're going to do whatever they want with it. Yeah. Now, they're going to testify, actually.
Well, no, they're going to.
Are they just getting questioned? And if we could have the panel come forward, if we're here. The first that I want to introduce is Rick Sherrow. He is an Army-trained arson investigator.